96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Good morning. Police back in public schools. 13 officers placed in 9 schools. National Security Minister Wayne Monroe says the government is serious about crime despite F&M critiques. And March is National Substance Abuse Prevention Month. We are talking with the Bahamas National Drug Council about the challenges they're facing in the country. It's all straight ahead this morning. I'm Dwight Strachan, and this is Morning Blend. Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day. It's the start of the start of a new way. You know that it's the start of the end of the old way. Good morning again, Bahamas. It is Wednesday, March 30th, 2022. This is Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Again, I'm Dwight Strachan. In a moment, Chester Robards will be joining us. Also this morning, we'll be talking about where things stand with Junkanoo and relief for Grand Bahama vendors. It's all straight ahead, but first, it's time for the overnight, the latest breaking news from while you're sleeping, and the top national and international headlines this morning. In the overnight, the Davis administration has reintroduced the presence of police officers in government schools. Assistant Commissioner of Police Craig Stubbs says that 13 officers have been deployed to 9 schools in New Providence, with another 3 schools under consideration for deployment. The 9 schools, Government High, Doris Johnson Senior High, R.M. Bailey Senior High, C.C. Sweeting Senior High, C.V. Bethel Senior High, S.C. McPherson Junior High, T.A. Thompson Junior High, A.F. Adderley Junior High, and C.H. Reeves Junior High. Stubbs telling the National Guardian that the intention is for officers to be at the schools to assist the administration with initiatives that will incur disruption within the schools, within the classes, or with students engaging in physical altercations. He says they will aim to identify students who may be involved in gang activities and reach out with their supporting departments like the National Crime Prevention Unit to assist students with dealing with conflict resolution and other issues that may cause a student to be disruptive during the time that they are on the school campus. While the deployment of police officers to schools follows the stabbing of a male student at A.F. Adderley Junior High on March 23rd, that while speaking about the incident in Parliament that same day, National Security Minister Wayne Monroe said the stabbing was believed to be gang-related. Stubbs, meanwhile, says the police force will document daily the activities at schools in order to identify students associated with gangs. Responding to criticism from the Free National Movement and F&M leader Michael Pintard, National Security Minister Monroe defending the government's efforts to combat increasing levels of violent crimes in the country. Monroe says that after being sidelined by the men's administration, Deputy Commissioner of Police Clayton Fernander is again at the forefront of that effort. He says Deputy Commissioner Fernander indicated that he's putting together the same team that he led that reduced murders to under 100 before he was sidelined by the F&M. He says, other participants at the conclave involved people who are concerned with engaging people before they become criminals, and they're looking at the whole issue holistically. On Sunday, Prime Minister Philip Davis convened that urgent conclave with high-level stakeholders to address a recent spate of murders. FN leader Pintar was critical of the conclave, saying it was nothing more than a briefing, as he issued a list of recommendations to address crime in the country. Monroe says the opposition is insincere in its claims of wanting to be bipartisan. He says, quote, it is kind of disingenuous when you don't know and come with prepackaged plans. Either you tried those plans in the past and it didn't work, or you didn't try them and you have to explain why you didn't try them. But I'm not an optimist for them to be sincere in their approach, but I do hope that they will change course and become sincere. Minister of Grand Bahama Ginger Moxie says the cabinet has approved a $177,000 relief package for vendors in Grand Bahama. Moxie says that for those in Port Lucaya, these are available for the vendors in the farmers market downtown as well. They've been affected since Hurricane Dorian. The fish fry vendors in 8 Mile Rock will also be eligible for this, including the vendors in the harbor area. Overseas, Russia's pledge to scale back some military operations in Ukraine, drawing skepticism, a bitter reality check, and a rare moment of optimism 5 weeks into what has devolved into a bloody war of attrition. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky says there was no reason to believe Russia's announcement that it would reduce military activity near Kyiv, the capital, as well as in the northern city of Chernihiv, given what's happening on the ground. He said in his nightly video address to the Ukrainian people that they call those signals that we hear at the negotiations positive, but those signals don't silence the explosions of Russian shells. Still, Tuesday's talk stretched out what could end up being a framework for ending the war that has imposed an increasingly punishing toll, with thousands dead and more than 4 million Ukrainians fleeing the country. The talks had been expected to resume today, but with the Turkish foreign minister calling meaningful progress made, two sides decided to return home for consultations. At the conference in Istanbul, Ukraine's delegation laid a framework under which the country would declare itself neutral and its security would be guaranteed by an array of other nations. The Russian defense minister saying that Moscow would, in the meantime, fundamentally cut back military activity in the direction of Kyiv and Chernihiv to, quote, increase mutual trust and create conditions for further negotiations. He did not spell out what that would mean in practical terms. In sports, Bahamas producing another Carifta qualifier in javelin after Blue Chips Athletics' Tayshia Stubbs achieved the standard in the under 17 girls division at the B3A's Road to Carifta qualifying meet over the weekend. Also qualifying for Carifta was Stubbs' teammate Danielle Nixon in the under 17 girls shot put event, that meet hosted by Star Trackers Track and Field Club at the Thomas E. Robinson National Stadium. It gave athletes an opportunity to qualify before the team was chosen on Sunday, April 3rd. That's this week, Sunday. The final Carifta trials are set for this coming weekend. Overseas, well, from the NFL, it took a few years, and for fans, that's probably too long, but the NFL has heard the cries of unfair and has adjusted its overtime rules. Only for the postseason, though. The NFL is changing the sometimes controversial overtime rules to guarantee each side gets the ball in the playoffs. Concerned that the coin toss to begin the extra period has too much impact on postseason game results, the owners voted Tuesday to permanently approve a proposal presented by the Colts and Eagles. Beginning this season, if a team possessing the ball first in overtime scores a touchdown on that series, the opponent still gets a possession. In recent seasons, that touchdown would have ended the game. That second possession of overtime would extend beyond the initial 15-minute period if needed. Should that team tie the game, it would then become sudden death. Outcries began back in February 2017 Super Bowl when Tom Brady completed an incredible comeback from a 28-3 deficit to tie the game. The Patriots won the coin toss, marched to a touchdown, and beat the Falcons. In the 2018 season, New England won the AFC title on the first series of overtime without Kansas City getting the ball. When the same thing happened in Kansas City during this January's divisional game between the Bills and the Chiefs, won by KC, a groundswell became an uproar. That's sports, and that's the overnight. Time for your first look at weather. The country that will continue through tonight. Beachgoers should exercise caution along East and South Coast beaches due to the risk of rip currents. For all areas today, look for variably cloudy and breezy to windy conditions with a few stray showers possible through tonight. Small craft cautions in effect in the Northwest Bahamas. Small craft advisory remains in effect in the Central and Southeastern Bahamas. Winds east to southeast at 15 to 20 knots in the Northwest Bahamas, occasionally gusty. Easterly at 15 to 25 knots in the central and southeastern Bahamas. Seas 4 to 6 feet in the northwestern islands, but 5 to 8 feet in the central and southeastern Bahamas. Temperatures today getting up to around 82 Fahrenheit, 28 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down to about 64 Fahrenheit Celsius. That's your first look at weather this morning. We'll have your extended outlook coming up after traffic in just a bit. You're listening to Morning Blend. When we come back, we're discussing the day's top stories right here on your home for fresh news and smart talk all day, Guardian Radio 96.9. You know that this year, wake up. Off the end of the old way.
Tired of banks forcing you to use technology to bank the way they want you to? Your convenience is important. So no matter what your banking needs, Commonwealth Bank's friendly staff are always available in branch for that personal one-on-one service. But when you choose technology, our online and mobile banking app offers you state-of-the-art functionality. The choice is yours. Commonwealth Bank. Bank the way you want.
Technology serves to make our lives better, so why not your business too? At Custom Computers, we've been maintaining our knowledge and relationships with top tech companies since 1987 and carry only the most trusted brands like Apple, Microsoft, HP, and more. No company has helped more businesses build reliable IT systems than Custom Computers. You name it, we've done it. Call 396-1101 to talk to any of our business experts. Find trust in your tech. Count on Custom Computers.
It's over 5 years we've been here. Time to review our options.
CIBC First home ownership is a big deal, so move on merrily with CIBC First Caribbean. Switch your mortgage and you'll get half off the appraisal cost, commitment fee, and more. Enjoy up to $10,000 toward your switching cost.
A peaceful rest. Glad we moved to CIBC First Caribbean.
Merrily.
Terms and conditions apply. Visit CIBCFCIB.com/movemerrily for details.
Wake up. It's a new day. It's the start of a new way. You know that this year is the start of the end of the old way. Wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, it's a new day.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. streaming live on GuardianTalkRadio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas Channel 969 or BTC Flow Channel 612. Once again, I'm Dwight Strachan. Join me now, Chester Robards. Good morning, Chester.
Good morning.
Great to have you with us.
Glad to be here.
You sound very excited.
Yes, I am.
Wow, okay. We can feel it. Well, anyway, Ray, a lot to talk about. You can join the conversation as well. We are on Twitter. Tweet us at MorningBlend969 or Facebook, facebook.com/MorningBlend969. You can text us on the Guardian Radio text line powered by BTC, 422-GR96, 422-4796. Standard text rates apply. Coming up this morning, more weather and traffic. In a few minutes, we're going to be talking with the Bahamas National Drug Council. March is National Substance Abuse Prevention Month, and we have to admit it, we do have a substance abuse problem here, a number of substances, and we're going to talk about how bad it is, how serious a problem it is, and what we can do about it this morning. That's coming up. And later in Morning Glen Business, it seems that we're back on track to have Junkanoo, and what that means, what's possible, and more in business this morning. So as we said, a lot to get to. Let's begin, though, with what else is in the news. And in the news, the big headline in the NASA Guardian today, police back in schools, 13 officers placed in 9 schools. We're going to talk about that quite a bit this morning. We'll get to that in a moment. Just want to begin, though, with what the National Security Minister is saying in response to what the leader of the opposition had to say on Monday. On Monday, Michael Pintard talked about that conclave they were invited to by the Prime Minister. On Sunday, the urgent crime conclave, a meeting with some stakeholders, trying to figure out the path forward in the fight against crime. This in light of a number of murders this month alone, and, causing grave concern. So Pintard, speaking about this, in a letter to the Prime Minister and to the Minister of National Security, saying, during the past several weeks, our country, in particular on the island of Providence, has experienced an unusual increase in violent crime, specifically gun violence. This increase is of deep concern to the members of the opposition and myself. Now, he offered some had recommendations that were divided into operational, administrative, and intersectoral measures to be taken in the short term and medium term. Among the immediate operational steps, Pintard recommended increasing police presence in hotspots, deploying intelligence officers throughout the inner city communities, and extending the neighborhood watch program to over the hill communities. He also said efforts should be made to eliminate the habitat where criminality flourishes by getting rid of derelict cars, dilapidated houses, overgrown lots, and gathering spots for known criminal enterprises. Pintard said that more attention needed to be given to border protection and inspections, particularly of pleasure craft and private planes. He also suggested that regional partnerships be used to conduct undercover national security operations to infiltrate and dismantle organized gangs in the country. Now, he also called for the government to provide counseling for family and family members and friends of murder and rape victims. In the medium term, as it relates to administrative issues, Pintard recommended proper training at the top of the law enforcement agencies, a zero-tolerance approach to crime in communities and among law enforcement officers, and the refusal of political interference in the day-to-day operations of the agencies. Right, so all of that. Well, Monroe was responding to some of this, and also to Pintard, who suggested that the conclave on Sunday wasn't quite what they were hoping it was going to be, and saying that more needed. Saying, quote, nothing more than a briefing, as he issued a list of recommendations to address crime in the Bahamas. That's what Pintard said about it. Monroe's hitting back at that, though, saying that the government is serious about crime, and had some interesting things to say about the critiques. Take a listen to this report from our Tashina Robinson.
The Prime Minister's weekend conclave becoming a political football tossed back and forth by both sides. Today, it's National Security Minister Wayne Monroe criticizing opposition leader Michael Pintard. On Monday, Pintard said he was unimpressed with the PM's gathering of public, private, and civic stakeholders to address a spike in murders. Here's what Monroe had to say about that.
I'm skeptical about the opposition's sincerity and wanting to be bipartisan. They're disingenuous in a lot of what they do. So you come to a meeting with proposals, and you've not even been briefed as to what the problem is. That is like a doctor treating you without examining you. And so the Prime Minister may be of a different view, but I see their efforts as cynical and disingenuous.
On Monday, the day after Pintard participated in the crime conclave at the office of the Prime Minister, the Free National Movement released its own suggested crime-fighting strategy. The recommendations were divided into operational, administrative, and intersectoral measures to be taken in the short and medium term. Among the immediate operational steps, Pintard recommended increasing police presence in hotspots, deploying intelligence officers throughout inner-city communities, and extending the neighborhood watch program to these. Monroe was less than impressed.
When you don't know, you come with prepackaged plans. Either you tried those plans in the past and they didn't work, or you didn't try them and you have to explain why you didn't try them. But I'm not an optimist for them to be sincere in their approach, but I do hope that they will change course and become sincere. The Prime Minister is genuine about engaging everyone, because we're all in the same boat.
Robinson with that report there. All right, so, Monroe's making some interesting points. And as some of our texters are pointing out, well, hey, everybody knows these problems. We know we've identified these years ago. We just haven't been consistent with how to deal with them, or seem to know how to deal with them. So solving the problem.
You could say it plainly. They don't care to solve the problem.
What now?
They don't care to solve the problem.
I wasn't going to say that one, but okay. So that's what you're saying. Wow. Now, why do you say that?
Okay.
Because it hasn't been solved?
Well, it hasn't even been, the solutions haven't even been really put in place. Mm. He talked about better border control, you know, searching private planes and yachts. Since I came into media, the police have been saying that that's how guns have been getting into the country.
Yeah.
Why is there still more plans that need to be put into place? 12, 14, however many years, because they knew it before I came into media. Mm-hmm. Is there a real appetite to stop it, to change it? Mm-hmm. Or, you know, is there too much of something involved for certain people? I don't, you know, it just baffles me that we still saying these things.
Yeah. Let's hear what you have to say about it, folks. Give us a call, 323-6232. 325-4316, 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. What do you make of the timing of Pintard's message there? Right after the conclave, obviously there is work to be done, more meetings scheduled, more stakeholders to be involved. Would you release that then, or just be patient and wait, or is it all politics, or is
they probably need some better advisors on that side,
because on the F&M side.
Mm-hmm. Because, well, you know, Minister Monroe said it. It's like a doctor giving you a prescription without even telling you or trying to figure out what's wrong with you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, one of our listeners saying, that patient doctor reference was not used correctly because we all know what the problems are. But like Monroe said, to come with these solutions. Yeah.
They're dealing with a particular problem that's going on right now.
The gang stuff. Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, like Monroe says, if you know so well, then why weren't you doing this? And that's a good question. They'll call us 323-6232, 325-4316, 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. Remember, standard text rates apply. Let's go to the phone lines. Caller, good morning. You're on the air.
Good morning. Morning, Ben. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Good morning.
Yes. I would have thought that the leader of the opposition would have very well prepared for the conclave, and their old suggestions. And like the Minister of National Security would have said, is either that you've tried them and it didn't work, or you had them to put there. But then to seem as if you're upstaging the present administration. It's like being a schoolboy, you know. That stuff just look, man. We're in a real world, and we expect production from our sitting administration. And you being sincere with your suggestions, you know, we're building a country. It's almost been 50 years or independence. But we've got to be more sincere, and not just to seek power, but to execute duty. And the love country, you know. Thanks for letting me share.
Okay, all right. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Yeah.
He's right, because at some point, when do you stop playing politics and just really listen to what's going on, mm-hmm. and see how you can participate? I mean, it was the first meeting, you know, conclave or whatever they want to call it. It was the first one. Going to get answers and solutions in a bundle that could just be tossed into the street like a pokeball.
Right.
So, well, yeah, I think the statement and stuff was premature, but it's typical, which is unfortunate.
Yep, unfortunate indeed. Are you tossing pokeballs into the street, Chester?
I'm going to 3D print one soon and toss them at people.
Oh boy, you're getting a little aggressive in your old age. Let's go to the text line. Somebody says here, my, how Wayne Monroe and the PLP forgets. They hounded the former administration on every turn with foolish rhetoric and garbage. Now that the shoe's on the other foot, he's talking fool. That's an interesting way to look at it, Texter. How about we just call out everybody for criticizing every single thing and work together to solve our issues. How about that instead of, anyway, okay. But anyway, you're entitled to your opinion. Sure. Great. And this next one is about schools, and let's get to that. You can continue to text us or call in about the issue there, but schools. And the police back in schools after that student was stabbed. What was that, last week? Yep. And we are already, schools are barely back face to face in the public schools. And videos of fights every other day. Here we go again. So this is what we're seeing as a solution to deal with the problem, the unruliness on campuses. For more on this, take a listen to this report from our Jasmine Brown.
The decision to place officers back in schools comes nearly a week after a male student was stabbed at A.F. Adderley Junior High School. The Education Minister and National Security Minister both made the case for reinstating officers on campuses.
We are not going to sacrifice their future. Now, the issue of safety is a compelling one. And we have been obliged, we must do something to stabilize the environment.
The one thing that everyone agrees to is have a place in school. The police police the Bahamas, and schools are a part of the Bahamas.
Government High is not the only public school with an officer now attached. Other senior high schools include R.M. Bailey, C.C. Sweeting, C.V. Bathel, and Doris Johnson senior high schools. Police officers have also been reintroduced to a handful of junior high schools, including C.H. Reeves, T.A. Thompson, and A.F. Adderley. Hannah Martin says despite criticism in the past surrounding a school policing program that was introduced under the former Christie administration, she says there is now widespread support for the more recent move.
And we just need a collaborative effort of everybody in the community for us to do what we can to stabilize our young people.
Last week, Bahamas Union of Teachers President Belinda Wilson told the Nassau Guardian she would support officers in schools, as she said it would provide for another layer of protection for students and teachers. As for whether counselors will be armed, Monroe had this to say.
How they choose to equip the police who go into the schools would be a function of their intelligence, would be a function of what they need. The photos that I saw didn't show openly armed policemen, which doesn't mean that they're not armed. It simply means they're not openly armed.
Hannah Martin says while placing officers in some schools is an immediate fix, she says officials hope it will not have to be a permanent one. Reporting for Guardian News Network, I'm Jasmine Brown.
Okay. Let's get into it. What do you make of it? We know this has been controversial in the past, and I've been back and forth on this in the past as well. And this texter is saying, we run schools like prize when children act like criminals. I don't know. It might be the other way around, right? They're acting like criminals, and so you need to handle them in a different manner. Now, why are they acting like criminals? That's the question. Yes, and that's the question to all of our at the root of all of our crime problems, right? Why this desire to fight all the time so brutally? Why the desire to stab somebody who wrongs you, and worse sometimes? Why indeed? All right, so let's get your reaction. What do you make of it? A good thing, or at least a temporary fix, a needed temporary fix until things calm down, until the gang situation is addressed. Will that ever be addressed? We've had gangs since I've known myself. And I don't even know if this is the worst the gangs have ever been, actually. I actually don't think it is. But hey, 323-6232, 325-4316. 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. Because I remember in the 80s, it looked like we were going to have a major crisis. It was terrible, this stuff. They were telling you, don't wear this color anywhere. Don't do this, don't do that. Don't wear anything with a slogan on it or a logo, because that could be affiliated with a gang and you could get yourself in some big problems.
It was the same thing in the 90s, too.
Yeah. Let's hear what this caller has to say. Good morning. You're on the air.
Hey, good morning, Dwight.
Hi.
And good morning, Chester. Mr. Strachan, I don't want to take you back in time, but it seems to me, right, and it seems to a lot of other persons in this country, maybe they might have called your talk show or text. How is it that... It looks like when you give your headlines on things that basically you're going to speak about, but when it comes to certain issues in this country, and I could bring something to your attention, something yesterday, on the front page of your Guardian, it was talking about, the minister was talking about he can't give a really a good assessment or a good wording to speak on behalf of where the money went from the IDB with the food network. But I'm trying to figure out, this morning, I heard Karen Texter's texting. It seems to me like as long as it's the PLP, whether it's in social service, Ministry of National Security, tourism, wherever it is, as long as it's the PLP, you're going to have negative comments and people like your guests. It's like they tear the PLC apart. But needless to say, Mr. Philip Edward Brave Davis is the Prime Minister. Personally like it or not, that's the Prime Minister, and some of your people in this country,
what are you
they
trying
really
to say?
Need that.
That we are. That's what you're saying.
No, me, but I'm personally saying to you, certain things that you talk about when you start to talk about it, and you hear one or two persons text or call about it, then you change. I'm not telling you how to run your station, you know. I'm just telling you.
I'm still trying to get understand what you're accusing me of doing. What are you accusing me of doing?
I'm giving you a last example. A couple months ago, watch this now. Follow me on this. You had the situation with Mr. Gibson when they was talking about appointing him to BTC. That whole day, that whole week, all it was on started from 6:30 in the morning. And, well, all the talk show hosts didn't pick it up. But you in particular, Dwight, it's like you cherry pick when it comes to the PLP.
That's garbage. And I want you to talk to some F&Ms who feel the same way. We talk about what
I don't mean that to be rude. I'm not going to never disrespect you, brother. But I'm just saying I'm just saying it because people who don't call your talk show, they don't have to be PLPs or F&M. People that I talk to and come and call.
Are you
going to
talk about what we're talking about, the police in schools? Are you talking about that? That's what we're talking about. And I guarantee you that everyone feels this way. But this is what we want to talk about. And if you feel sensitive about it, that's on you. We're not picking on the PLP. We're not picking on the F&M. We are talking about what's impacting our country. And if you feel that you're being picked on, well, that's unfortunate. Do something. Fix it. I don't get any pleasure talking about the PLP or the F&M. So all of you need to calm down. Calm down, and let's try to fix this country, for God's sake. Okay, so we're talking about the police in schools because the kids are going wild. We're talking about that, or we want to talk about the PLP and F&M all day? No. Okay. 323-6232. 325-4316. Did the PLP save like someone's life? Did they like you were on the edge of a cliff and the PLP came in and swept? What's going on? What is that all about? And the F&M too, because I'm telling you right now, I'll get off the air and people will tell me, you're a terrible F&M. Oh my gosh, you're the worst PLP. When did you become a PLP? When did you become an F&M? And everybody hears something different. But all of you need help. Trust me, you need serious psychological help. Okay. Anyway, let's go to the text line. This texter says, Wayne Monroe has a voice now, but when those murders were taking place, mum was the word. I don't know which murders you're talking about. He hasn't stopped talking. This one says here, I don't know if this is someone suggested, some suggestions. This is some weird. We're tried under the PLP and 2012, 2013, the Urban Renewal Program, and the same year crime rose. So both parties need to go back to the drawing board and come up with new suggestions and solutions to combat the crime. This must have been done with for audio texts, because these are some very odd words here. This one says here, the PLP spread hate and duration with daily press releases and rhetoric from their chairman. Now they want unity for one Bahamas. Where was this mindset when the former administration was faced with many difficulties? Mm-hmm. Another one here. Are there programs in school to engage the children at break times? There should be, if it does not already exist, like clubs, et cetera, to address anger issues and where they can release their energy positively. I guarantee you there are. Chester, don't listen to Dwight. We love your new take and hard-hitting responses. Placating has its place. Placating has its place, but there are times when you just have to let it rip and state your true feelings, and to hell with those who defend it. Well, I hear you.
I mean, I don't know who could defend it, but it's the only answer to me.
Mm. Well, you know, I think called just now showed that we're more concerned about ticks than about the actual problems.
I mean, how many times are you going to hear people in power say the same, we have to get a what's the old Scruff McGruff was in? Take a bite out of crime. Mm-hmm. You know, we gotta get this under control. You know, we gotta see where these guns and drugs are coming in. Okay, you've been saying that, and I've been writing about it for almost 20 years.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you've told me where they're coming in. Mm-hmm. But you haven't increased the enforcement. Nobody has.
Crazy stuff. Let's take this call. Good morning, caller. You're on the air. You're talking about police and schools. Good morning.
Hey, good morning, Dwight.
Hi.
I'm Chester. Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, Dwight and Chester. Yeah, man. First of all, Dwight, you know, you have this very strong man, you know, because you do extremely well. Let me best put it to you like that. Don't worry yourself with the haters, you know, because, you know, when pressure is by his pipe and when people feel in the pain, they can cry, right? But I really wanted to touch on what you were talking about, right? When it comes to the crime situation in this nation, right? The impression I get from all administration, because you know I don't even care to call them PLPs or FLMs no more, because at the end of the day we get this exact same result from both. Right now somebody might show me some different result from any one of them, other than the fans that they have, right? But we get the same result as a people from both parties, right? And to see that they back and forth with this school issue and this crime issue is only says one thing to me, is that, you know, crime has to be the third industry inside this country, right? Because mm-hmm. Hey, you only can protect industries that would really put monies inside your treasury. And crime today is putting a lot of money inside the public treasury, more than even agriculture today, right? And these guys, they talking, but who we seeing really doing or trying to do to really put any dump dent to this this crime situation? 400,000 poison in a scattered location. I don't see it happening. I don't see the initiative being taken. All it is continuous talks about who did this and who need to do that. And so, as a nation, let me ask you this last question. Crazy mind, no, you crazy? Because of some of these, it appears that a lot of the insanity that exists in this country, people believe they're seeing.
But I think some do.
It's too much insanity in this country. The craziness that the people call on this radio and talk about protecting parties. And who's going to protect the Bahamas? Mm. Who designated to protect the Bahamas? Because the PLP or the FLM, they ain't designated to protect the Bahamas. You guys have a nice day.
All right, thank you very much. Appreciate it. All right, so I'm going to read some of these messages here. This is a lot about what the previous caller said.
If you'd like...
I'm going to edit. What's DeWitt on? Dwight, your show threw Menace out of power. Well, okay. What is he talking about? You talk about the issues. Another one. Dwight, I think you're... talk show is quite balanced and fair, and if any political parties or their followers can't accept critique, then stay out of public life. Another one. Bro, good morning. You run a great program, and you and the team do a great job. These chocolate tongue people, oh boy, need to stop with the crying. Another one here. What is DeWitt talking about? Dwight, I personally know that you are DNA, and of course, they could only do the laughing, crying face thing there, because that's quite hilarious, quite. Well, anyway, let's move on from that, folks. Let's talk about, again, what we're talking about here. Police and schools, is it that bad that we need to do this? And if it is, what are we going to fix? You know this, that they will take their beefs off campus. They'll wait till after school. They'll wait till they get away from the eyes of the police, and then they will do what they have to do. And then what? So, yes, the campuses are safer, but then the kids are out in the streets doing madness because nothing would have changed. This one says here, these grown men, these grown politicians need to stop being childish and tit for tat. Just tired of all of them talking nonsense. We are all Bahamians and need sound solutions. We should vote for a brand new party next time. Get rid of these recycled politicians. Employers mandated that the, oh dear, what is this now? Oh, this is clearly not for this show. Okay. Syphilis was in there. Chester, so no, not this morning. Okay. That was for a previous show, I think, at Texas. It slipped in there from last night, perhaps. Regarding the murders in Archer, Wayne Monroe states that the F&M government's crime plan did not work, but maybe before he speaks, he should check the data. In each of the 3 full years the previous F&M government was in power, the murder count was under 100, including 2018, before the pandemic started, and this was after the country experienced a whopping 140 record-breaking murders in 2015 under the Christie administration.
Well, we'll need some experts to look into that correlation.
Yeah. This one says here, if my child's private school advised that they were putting police in school due to students' violence, I would be moving him to another school in a flash. Police in schools is a failure of the schools, the government, and communities to address the growing dysfunction among children and youth, an issue that has existed for over 10 years. You need to talk time. I'd say maybe 25, if not more. But yeah, okay, that's a good point there. That's a good point there. There would be schools if they had to do that. There would be extreme outrage, but there's the totally different reaction from most people here in the public school system. What does that say? What does that say? Tell us what you think. 323-6232. 325-4316. 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. We'll get to that call in a second. This texter says, stop blaming innocent people for crime and domestic violence. Huh?
What? That's all they say?
No. But I'm just trying to process it. Stop blaming innocent people for domestic violence. And stop criminal activities. You must deal with the culture of crime in government and greater society. I blame, I don't know. You can drastically reduce crime by applying money or fines and reparations to the victims instead of punishing with jail for most of these crimes. Reparations to the victims. Who's going to give money to the victims? The perpetrator?
They're saying reparations to victims will help to solve crime?
Yeah, instead of punishing with jail time. So I guess what? The perpetrator has to work for them or work off, pay them, but they probably didn't have anything before. That's why they got into... I'm not sure. Some of these points, I think I know where you're going, and I think some of them are sound, but you just randomly just sprinkling, so it's a little... off, you know, all over the place, but I get where you're going, and I do think some of that stuff they call it what, restorative justice that is required and needed in some cases here, as opposed to jail time. So you're on to some things definitely, and that has been proposed for wider use. Yeah, so I get you. Thank you, texter. Caller, good morning. You're on the air.
Okay, this is Zach. Anyway, so long with you and Chester Dwight.
Hi, good morning.
Dwight, I want to say several things, but twice I want to say, I agree with the brother who said that you were trained. And I said the same thing, you know, I listened to you, right? And the things, what I see you is put a bit, I said to myself, you came from decent family. Because you know to deal with it, you know, those situations. But this is what I want to say, right? Oh, and of course, Chester made some interesting point. He will... right on. But, you know, somebody talked about the money, right, in which people want those politicians, whosoever, wants people to pay. I agree. The thing is, right, now this is not my main point, but I was in a situation where somebody took somebody to court. They then go to court, and I had to call the police for them because they continue doing foolishness bothering me. And you know, I went to the station, you know what they want me to do? To pay more money to go back to court, which is crazy, and they're supposed to pick up the person, and they hadn't picked him up. Pintard made an interesting point, right? I'm not into the text thing on those who are using the Bahamian people with this politics to do. I don't respect them. But what I want to say, what Pintard had said, right, he talked about putting the police in the areas. And that's the fact. If that were to happen, the crime would go down. You see what I'm saying? Because when the police are around, those guys would hide themselves. You see? They would stay put. So I agree with Pintard. And I don't respect people who play politics with people. Like one brother talked about looking out for the Bahamas, right? The thing is, the Queen and her successors would look out for the Bahamas, but nobody looking out for the Bahamian people that are in the Bahamas, and that's the problem. Thank you for your time.
Okay, thank you very much. Appreciate it. Okay, I was going to say it. It really did when Brayman said that, but I had to stop myself because maybe this is inappropriate. I was going to say, yeah, thank you, Brayman. I'm a Chris Rock, but not on the Will Smith side, but then that's going to just start something else, right? So I'll take the punishment and keep the show going. But that's not, no. Right, Chester?
That's right. Keep that joke to yourself.
Right. Yes. Yes, I should have done that. Okay, a few messages before we go to the break. We've been down this road before. POP, FNM don't have a solution for the crime situation. It seems as if they don't really care about the country. Well, that's a bit extreme, isn't it? But
no, but you know, people feel that way, though. You can't help but feel that way in some instances.
Yeah, I mean, I think what the previous caller said, that it is a big business. We have to admit that, right? It is creating many opportunities, whether it's lawyers or funeral homes, unfortunately, doctors and nurses and pharmacies when you get injured, and more security companies. We've got a thriving industry as a result of crime,
and the degrees of separation in this country sometimes trickle into criminal people. Mm-hmm. Got to admit that some people get it to some people who criminals.
Yeah.
In some way, shape, or form.
Wow. Someone was texting on our tweeting us, Therein lies the problem of the country. No one knows how to stay on topic. You're talking about police and schools, and they're all talking about something else. Yeah, when it's the big issues, I do notice that. I do notice that a lot. It's very, very disturbing. All right, a few more messages here. I went to school in Delray Beach, Florida in 1988, and I recall there were two police officers with a patrol car. I don't know why your previous texter is saying that having police on campus is making criminals in school. I beg to differ, because I see students are more violent these days compared to the 80s when I was in school.
Well, you know, that's true. I never thought about it. But when I was in school in the States, I see it all the time, especially when school's coming out. And I don't know if it's traffic control, but maybe also just protection. Police were always around schools in the States.
Like literally around, though? Or were they on the campus?
Well, unfortunately, they're on the campus now because of school shootings. But they used to be, like I said, like during the times when school was letting out, they would be on the streets around the schools, around the area. Mm. Probably helping to direct traffic and give you a ticket if you're speeding in the school zone too. But
This text here, police and schools, the last time I checked, the schools didn't have a working metal detector or wands. So what are the police going to do? Feel the children up now? What's going to happen without equipment?
What? Anyway, so you didn't play the part of the clip where Wayne Monroe explained about security guards in schools, right?
No. What did he say?
That they're not there to protect anything other than government property.
Who are?
Security guards.
Security guards are only there.
Hired by the Ministry of Education or whoever hires them. That's the only thing they're there to protect.
So if they see the kids fighting, as long as it won't destroy a desk.
They're not obligated to go and enter and break up a fight.
Well, right. I guess that's the administrator. That's the administration's issue.
I don't even know if it's there. So.
Because do the administrators have the tools to enter a fight where there might be weapons involved?
Definitely not. Wow. Okay. This one says here, police in school is a beginning. I think this issue in part is a, in school is a part of the bigger gang problem. I think we really need to address the gang problem. It's a sad state in our country when police are needed to be in schools. I don't see how the schools are safer because a police officer is there. Really? If the kids have beef with each other, what is one officer going to do about that when criminals aren't afraid of the whole force?
Is it when criminals aren't afraid?
I don't know about that, Texter. Now, unfortunately, we have seen videos in the past off campus when there's a fight, especially with girls, and officers try to break up the fight and that doesn't do a thing. Now, that's something else. But I think before it gets to that point on campus, the presence of a police officer will do something to deter behavior, without a doubt. But again, are you addressing the issue? And once you're away from the campus and away from the eyes of the police, will that mean that your desire to do whatever you wanted to do will be gone? And I don't think that will be the case. And so you just will take it to, and well, you can't go to the malls, eh? We'll take it wherever you go and then do what you got to do, which is frightening because we haven't gotten to the root of the problem. But at least there won't be an issue on the campus. Couple more messages here. Someone says here, the children were out of school for 2 years. Did anyone counsel the children when they returned to school? At least one day a week? There should be a counseling session.
Hey, if anybody wants to help in schools, you know, there are several schools that have family life classes that need teachers that Grace Community Church helps to facilitate. You could just call up Grace and, you know, go into a school and do what you can do.
Mm-hmm.
I think everybody needs to lend a hand in this situation, in guiding these kids.
Absolutely. This text here, you steal, rob, kill, you should have to pay for that person's medical or funeral loss of income. And yes, take their assets and sell it if they don't have assets, as if that follow-up to that text before. They have to be made to work until they pay the cost, all of it back.
Work from where a person?
Yeah, like, right. Well, and often they weren't working before, so they're going to get a job. That's what you're saying. So they will now be hired, even though they weren't working before, so that they can pay off their debt to the victims of their crime.
And what kind of assets would those kinds of people have? We could hardly own assets as middle-class people. I'm a middle-class.
I think there are going to be a lot of people, if that's the case, I mean, again, who's going to hire them? There's going to be a lot of people who will probably commit a crime so they could get a job. But I hear you. If they, wow, okay. I think the crime situation can't be handled due to bad assumptions by the police force. I think
cannot be handled?
Yeah, you need to explain that text.
So are you talking about police intelligence?
I don't know. Another one here. The problem with young people stems from the home. These homes are dysfunctional and parents expect schools to raise their children. Schools have to give out prizes and provide refreshments just to bribe parents to come to meetings. It's ridiculous. They need to take responsibility for their children. Dwight, in 2019, MP Chester Cooper and Senator Moss both called for the age of consent to be changed to 18 instead of 16. It will definitely cut down on the sexual exploitation by men and women. This is my view. It was a brilliant idea and should have taken place, but it didn't. Think it'll cut down on the sexual exploitation? We just have more people charged, I suspect. Just have a whole lot more people charged with crimes. Okay. There are solutions to crime. There is just no political will to address crime. It is our third national industry, so they will keep putting Band-Aids on the problem. Another one here. 13 police officers going to 9 schools. Please list the schools so we can know the 9 schools that have violence issues. We did earlier. And they sound like most of the schools. So, I mean, do you really need me to? Okay. Government High School, Doris Johnson Senior High, C.V. Bethel Senior High, S.C. McPherson Junior High, T.A. Thompson Junior High, A.F. Adderley Junior High, and C.H. Reeves Junior High. And they said that more might be added to this. Another 3 under consideration. That sounds like everything. What wasn't there? Oh, C.I. Gibson wasn't there. That's interesting. And A. Joe Nash. Boy. Mm-mm-mm. And this text here as we go to the break. Dwight, I don't like what I'm seeing. We have police that say they are in fear for their lives and have issues policing the community, and we're putting them around our children now. We haven't fixed the police issue yet. Are they going in schools with body cameras too? That's a good question. That is a very good question. Let's take this call. Good morning.
Yes, good morning, Dwight. Good morning, Chester.
Hi.
Yeah, you know, Dwight, the last text, it was spot on. I think they've obviously, if they could be in the schools, they should have the cameras, right? And so there was a few texts back when the police talk about dysfunctional homes and et cetera, et cetera. But I was kind of disappointed in the person who lives in a utopia, right, saying that, you know, if the police were put in the private schools, she'd take a child out of the school. That may be, that's her right. She must bear in mind the fact that children are not emotionally developed and have a level of what you call emotional maturity, right? So they really are just learning themselves. And so when you live in the inner city, I've been to government school and private school, and I've listened to the narratives of these kids moving in and out the thoroughfares they walk past. And so the word public school means it's the public. So when someone sends their child there, your parents who really want their children to learn. So it's kind of diversified. It's not all one fits all. The parents want the school to raise their children. So the children are going to school and they're in the public school, and they have a right to be in a safe environment while they're on the campus. Now, what they do subsequently, the police could set a parameter for that, but they should be in those schools. But the fact that you have police being put in junior schools, right, Dwight, shows the proliferation of the gang culture.
Yeah.
That they're downplaying. Listen to me, Dwight. That's the sense of it. If it's starting from junior school, and I go in the police force, or I go in the defense force, or I go in another government office, what that means? I'm affiliated because I have friends, and this is what the social ecosystem is trying to deny, that the gang culture isn't spread all about as people move on and up in society. So we could deny it all we want. But I agree with you, Dwight. You do display the art of indifference and emotional intelligence on the radio, right? But you have to understand, kids don't have that ability, Dwight. When you have a technological paradigm in which you have a book that cannot be read called Facebook, right? And people are passing remarks and et cetera, et cetera. You're going to have these contentious type vendettas, even from just little statements she did some work for. I wouldn't call her name, and I wouldn't say what school it is. But she told me, a male principal, locked himself in the office because he was afraid of a student as far as violence. I don't know what the student had. But when you see it like that, in the day when I was going to school, that can never happen. But these things exist. You don't understand. Like I said, junior schools, police fear, gang violence. Why is it that the teachers them should be put themselves in this position to try and figure out the social ills as far as the dysfunction of society? And the thing is, if the government could really, or criminals are riding up and down in tinted cars. So you're facilitating certain things. You have this silly mandate about the mask outside. So the guys are using excuse to wear masks because they're not, I don't want to say the word. You see what I'm saying? So the society in itself is breeding this dystopian society. Because you see the guys riding around with these masks covering their face, talking about the pandemic. Man, come on, man, Dwight. They're facilitating it in ignorance. Have a good day.
Great points. Thank you very much. Yeah, I think, can you imagine if they said that we realize that we have to put them in primary schools as well? Would that make people more aware of how serious the problem is? And I'm sure some will suggest, yeah, some of these sixth graders, we see it. We see what the future holds for them. And I'm sure some teachers will say, we wish we need some help. We need some help with them. Very scary. We got let's take this call really quickly, and then we've got to go to the break. Good morning, call. You're on the air.
Good morning, guys. How are you this morning?
Doing well. Good morning.
I think putting the bullies back in school would be a good thing, but we also need to implement a social program. You know, school gets out at most schools get out at 3 o'clock, right? Right, Dwight?
Yeah.
Okay, what they can do before they allow the students to leave the school campus. Have the community police come to the schools that having the most problems right now and speak to the students before they are allowed to leave the school campus and give them another warning so the parents nor the kids can say they weren't warned when they go in the streets to act accordingly. I think that would help curb some of the problem. You can't stop all the problem, but you're able to slow it down. You understand what I'm saying to you?
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think that's the program that they need to implement. Let those kids stay back another 15 or 20 minutes, have an assembly, and let a senior community police officer speak to them before they leave the school campus and just give them some schooling, telling them how to act when they go in the streets because they're representing the school and plus they're representing the rest of the young kids. Thank you, man. And they can move around from school to school.
All right. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. And this text as we go to the break. Dwight, when are we going to hold parents responsible for their children's actions? That's a whole show, eh? That's very controversial. Very controversial. Boy, oh boy. Let's take this break. When we come back, we're going to be talking about substance abuse in the country. Is that contributing to some of the problems we're seeing? We're going to get into that and more with the Bahamas National Drug Council. This is Morning Blend on a Wednesday morning here on Guardian Radio 96.9. Stay with us.
We've got to find a way. We've got to make a change. We've got to find a way. What's the solution for crime? Too much people are dying. What's the solution for crime? To lose them life. What's the solution for crime? Too much people are dying. What's the solution for crime? Too much use. I lose them life. Politicians stop pointing finger upon each other. Why you don't wise up and start work together? Doesn't make any sense. You cast the blame. They all out know are the same.
It's time for your first look at traffic for this morning, brought to you by RBC Royal Bank. We are seeing some heavy traffic in some hot spots, but also some traffic in some spots that don't normally see traffic at this hour. And it appears on Tawny Glooms on the highway, we've got an accident that's causing some delays. And that's westbound as you approach the roundabout with Bombs Games Boulevard. You've seen some heavy traffic between that roundabout and the roundabout with Blue Hill Road and Independence Drive. So keep that in mind if you're on Tawny Green Starling Highway there. And then on JFK Drive, you're seeing some heavy traffic just west of Lake Cunningham on the way to the roundabout with Westridge. So keep that in mind there. Heavy traffic westbound there. Elsewhere, back to Blue Hill Road. That traffic is very heavy, just north of Soldier Road on the way to the roundabout with Independence Drive and Tawny Glooms Darling Highway. As you said, there's issues on Tawny Glooms Darling Highway westbound from that roundabout, backed up along Independence Drive westbound to the roundabout. The traffic eastbound to Blue Hill Road and westbound, the traffic is building to Coral Harbor Road. Milo Butler Highway, as usual, heavy traffic from Fire Trail Roundabout up to Tawny Glooms Darling Highway, and Gladstone Road, heavy traffic northbound to the roundabout with JFK Drive. Those are your hottest spots, and then we're seeing the building traffic on Soldier Road northbound to Bernard Road, Wolf Road, and Village Road, and westbound on Eastern Road from San Suzy to Johnson Road. Those are your hot spots. That's your real-time traffic and your Morning Glen traffic alert brought to you by the Ministry of Health and the Pan American Health Organization. Reminding you that COVID-19 vaccines and boosters are safe, effective, and protect you against getting seriously ill, being hospitalized, and dying from COVID virus. The vaccine offers the best protection against COVID-19 when combined with physical distancing, hand washing, or sanitizing, and wearing your face masks properly. Visit vax.gov.bs to book an appointment or simply walk into any of their locations.
When you're hunting for your first home, it can feel like a lot.
With RBC by your side, your home-owning journey can be stress-free. And Mortgage Specialist will meet you almost anywhere. And you'll benefit from flexible repayment terms, lower upfront costs, and cash back where it matters. Pre-qualify to see what you can afford. Start at rbc.com/Caribbean/mortgages. Limited time offer.
Technology serves to make our lives better, so why not your business too? At Custom Computers, we've been maintaining our knowledge and relationships with top tech companies since 1987 and carry only the most trusted brands like Apple, Microsoft, HP, and more. No company has helped more businesses build reliable IT systems than Custom Computers. You name it, we've done it. Call 396-1101 to talk to any of our business experts. Find trust in your tech. Count on Custom Computers.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
We know how important it is to your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services. From click and pay options online to merchant terminals and e-commerce options. We're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches.
Screws and Fasteners World, Balfour Avenue and Palm Beach Street, has those hard-to-find fasteners for you right now. You can find stainless steel regular hex, carriage bolts, galvanized bolts, threaded rods, nails, self-tap screws, sex bolts, anchor bolts, turnbuckles, masonry tools, hand tools, and weed whacker strings. Check out the rope selection and car body fasteners, too. Special orders are welcome. It's your number one fastener store. Screws and Fasteners World, Balfour Avenue and Palm Beach Streets. Call 326-1976.
Let Wendy's heat up your morning. Wake up with our new hot honey chicken biscuit that is forged in flavor and made fresh every morning just for you. Forged from a fusion of sweet honey and spicy heat. Wendy's new hot honey chicken biscuit is our breaded premium all-white chicken breast topped with habanero honey served on a fresh-baked buttermilk biscuit. It offers the perfect balance of sweet heat. Better mornings always start at Wendy's.
Now, the best rates just got better because you pay half the price of the other guys with your BTC home internet and mobile services combined. Switching to BTC is a no-brainer because I pay less with BTC and get super fast internet with speeds up to 600 megs. The other guys, their internet only go up to 105 megs.
Get all the internet you want at half the price when you bundle your home internet and mobile. Visit a BTC store to make the switch today. Conditions apply.
Paying your share of the bill? Done! Music subscription? Renewed.
Hey, happy birthday.
Someone's birthday? Take care of it. Your life is online and so is your bank. With CIBC First Caribbean, there are many ways to send money. You can use First Pay to transfer money to other CIBC First Caribbean clients instantly, like when you're splitting the dinner bill. And First Send lets you transfer funds internationally. You can even set up recurrent payments with our mobile app to pay subscriptions, rent, and bills. Choose the best in digital banking so you can live your best life. Best in digital banking based on number of products and services.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Welcome back to Morning Blend here on Guardian Radio 96.9. We are streaming live on guardiantalkradio.com and on the Guardian Radio app for smart devices. We're also on your televisions on Cable Bahamas Channel 969 and BTC Flow Channel 612. You can tweet us at morningblend969 or facebook.com/morningblend969. Text us 422-4796. And now at 8:21, time for another check of your weather for today, brought to you by Bahamas First Insurance. We've got strong high pressure that continues to promote moderate to locally fresh winds across the country through tonight. Beachgoers should exercise caution along east and south coast beaches due to the risk of rip currents. For all areas today, look for variably cloudy and breezy to windy conditions. Small craft cautions in effect for the northwest Bahamas. Small craft advisory in effect for the central and southeastern islands. Temperatures today getting up to around 82 Fahrenheit, 28 Celsius. Overnight lows tonight getting down to about 64 Fahrenheit, 18 Celsius. In your extended outlook, high pressure will continue across the islands into Friday while moving eastward. So for Thursday, tomorrow, variably cloudy and breezy to windy with a chance of a stray shower or two. Friday, partly cloudy and warm with isolated showers over the northwest Bahamas. Partly sunny and warm with a slight chance of a stray shower elsewhere. That's your Morning Blend weather check, brought to you by Bahamas First Insurance. What's first for you comes first for us. Day 23, time for another check of your traffic for this morning, brought to you by RBC Royal Bank. In your real-time traffic, we're still having some serious issues on Tawny Quilton's Darling Highway in some spots that we don't normally see at this hour. So westbound, just Venice Drive, you're going to be seeing heavy traffic as you approach Bahamas Games Boulevard and roundabout there. So keep that in mind. That's westbound. And the traffic is also building eastbound. As you approach the roundabout with Blue Hill and Independence Drive. So heavy traffic and an unusual situation there on Tawny Quilton's Darling Highway. Eastbound to the roundabout with Bahamas Games Boulevard, also building traffic there. Whereas westbound, close to as you approach Tawny Quilton's Darling Highway, looking much, as you approach Milo Butler Highway, looking much better for you. We suspect there's the aid of a traffic cop there. And so Milo Butler Highway, not bad at all this morning. Just about, you'll encounter the traffic midway between Fire Trail and the roundabout in the northbound lanes this morning. Further up, though, there are issues as you head toward Sports Center Road and the six-legged roundabout. So keep that in mind if you're on. Road not looking as good, but heavy traffic in the northbound lane and toward the roundabout with JFK Drive. And still some congestion on JFK Drive westbound as you approach Westridge this morning. Carmichael westbound, heavy traffic on the way to Coral Harbor Road. And then there's the usual Independence Drive traffic, both directions backed up west and eastbound this morning between the roundabouts of Blue Hill Road and East Street, and pockets along East Street looking very busy, especially between Robinson and Soldier Road. And then there's Robinson Road between Soldier and Old Trail Road, heavy traffic westbound. And Soldier is busy for you north of that intersection with Robinson all the way up to Village Road. And the heavy congestion there, Bernard Wolf Village and Soldier. Eastern Road, as usual, heavy traffic between San Susie and Johnson Road westbound. And pockets along Prince Charles Drive, especially near Beatrice Avenue and at the Fox Hill intersection. So lots that you're dealing with this morning. Good luck to you. That's your real-time traffic and your Morning Blend traffic alert brought to you by RBC Royal Bank.
Wake up today. wake up, it's a new day. Wake up, start off the start of a new way. You know that.
And we are back here with Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strachan with Chester Robards. And it is National Substance Abuse Prevention Month. Here to talk about this from the Bahamas National Drug Council, we're very pleased to have with us, Antoinette. Great to have you on the show. Good morning.
Bahamas.
Good morning. Always a pleasure, man. That's been a while. All right, so we'll get into how you're going to be celebrating the month in a bit and get some details about the Drug Council. But let's talk about it. Substance abuse in the Bahamas. Where are we? Lots of people have a lot of theories, but it's based on anecdotal evidence, what they see or they think they know. But what's the reality? How bad? How bad is it?
Well, the Bahamas National Drug Council is actually a governing agency. What we do is we are charged with overseeing the treatment facilities as far as the way they're carrying out what it is that they are doing. What we're seeing, because we go into the schools and, of course, and different agencies, is that things aren't as good as they need to be. Wow. And so we are very guarded and we are very vigilant and we're trying to get it out there. You know, there's a thought, marijuana is a herb, it's good, but it's not. And it's just getting the right information out because as we all know, bad news travels faster than good news. So the thought that, the wrong news, which is, it's okay, it's not okay. And we're trying to get the word out that it's not okay.
Okay, you said a lot just now. Is it marijuana that is the big concern, or are we seeing, we do in other parts of the world, where some folks are on some very serious prescription medications and other types of narcotics?
Marijuana is a big concern. Also, alcohol. Many don't think, or many would not believe, the proliferation of the use of alcohol, especially because of the lockdowns and during. And then there are other things that come up. My colleague, I'll let Mandel elaborate on the other things that are being used right now.
So other than the our traditional forms of drugs, be it marijuana or alcohol, we also have challenges here at home, particularly with our youth population, with MDMAs, which would be normally known to the public as ecstasy or Molly. These drugs are known as party rave drugs, and they're becoming very prevalent among young people in terms of usage. And so these are some of the things in particular that we're on the lookout for and have already started campaigns to encourage persons and parents, the communities at large, to avoid the use of these types of drugs due to the amount of synthetic additive and the harm that it does to our physical bodies. We've just recently, through our director and the person of Dr. Novia Luki Carter, we've just recently started to be able to show, when we do our talks around the community, be able to show what the brain looks like from the effects of these drugs, whether it be MDMAs, marijuana, or alcohol. We're now able to show people what the brain looks like on use or when in use or with abuse of these drugs versus the normal use of the brain. And so it's things like that that we're trying to utilize to heighten the awareness within the community about the use of these dangerous drugs and the need for us to provide intervention and the need for us to, as a council, to be that place where people can turn to for healing and treatment and the likes.
So with those type drugs, are you seeing it as in abuse, as in when you're partying, or people becoming addicted to them and using them even in an environment like that?
Okay, so we all know it only takes one time for someone to become hooked on any substance. The way your body may react to something, my body may be different. I may have a higher tolerance for a particular substance, whereas you don't. And so one time you have some gummies that are oversaturated with THC or whatever have you, and then your body craves that particular feeling over and over again, whereas I do it and I'm good with it. You understand what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And so it's the understanding of that aspect of it, how the body moves.
And so during our drug prevention month, which we're in 40 days of drug prevention activities, these are the times that we use to, again, like I said, as our outreach officer, try to heighten the awareness in our communities, within our school systems, and among the general population on how these drugs affect our day-to-day functions and what preventions are available, what interventions are available for the community. One of the purpose of the council is to be committed to the development and the universal and selective prevention of intervention and treatment, rehabilitation, and social reintegration. And so at the council, we have carriage and responsibility for all of these various responsibilities. The mission is to reduce the demand for illegal drugs. People would say, I remember when I first started at the council, I think at the time our director said, we're moving away from just say no to more so helping people to be responsible, realizing that in spite of us saying no, having said no for so many years, that did not stop the flow or the increase of the demand for illegal drugs. And so it required us to be more proactive in providing intervention programs and seeing the need for it in the community. And I can tell you on a daily basis, we're out there in our communities dealing with people that have the effect of drug use. Beyond the drug use that we do at the council, realizing that drug has a connection to so many other social ills, we're normally responding to acts of violence that may be related to drug use or of any other social behavior that may be impacted by drug use. So you will find that now at the Bahamas National Drug Council, we have carriage of what we call the technical work for the approach of violence and crime, because drugs and violence and crime kind of go hand in hand here in the country. And you'll find us responding to various aspects of social ills, because in most cases, again, they are a gateway to either drug use or drug use being the gateway to these social activities. And so whether it be us understanding as a council that our young people have been out of school and in the communities for the last 2 years, we all as a people know what go on in our communities, and thereby that gives us a snapshot of what these young people have been challenged with. And so since school has returned face-to-face, we've been visiting various, dealing with different issues, trying to help our educators get our kids to refocus and debunk some of the stuff that they would have encountered in the last 2 years. And we want to encourage parents to get engaged with your kids in a new way, understanding that there are some things out there that we have to deal with before we can continue to just educate them.
My goodness. I don't envy the work that you all do. You recall the situation a few weeks ago with a student brought some gummies, I think, or candies on the campus, and a number of children ingested them, and a couple had to go to the hospital.
Yes.
And the reaction that we got was mixed. People were like, what's the big deal? It was shocking. Yep.
Okay.
And then you're jumping in, you're excited to talk about it. But that's a big problem, though.
There was an intervention held a few days later, and that was at the academy. At that intervention, myself along with our director, as well as members from the Drug Enforcement Unit, we just kind of brought to the forefront, one, the dangers, I don't think our children think about the legal ramifications of these kind of things. And so we brought to the forefront, along with DEU officers, I think Ms. Sullivan, and I can't remember the other lady's name, but they had the drug dogs out there, and just really giving an eye-opening intervention to the students. You know, kids are vulnerable, and we as parents, we need to, as my colleague was saying just now, you really need to talk to your children because they're being exposed to so many things, and failure to talk to them, to share with them, to tell them, to break it down to them will, you know, cause them. You're not telling your child what is right or wrong. Somebody else is going to tell it to them, and they may not tell it to them in the right way.
Dwight, yeah. One of the things, people say this may not be a big issue. Let me show you the difference between it may not be a big issue and it is a very serious issue. Mm-hmm. For years, traditionally, we've had, whether it be the Rasta men or the boys on the corner smoking traditional forms of marijuana with the traditional tobacco wrap leaves approach. Now here you have this this innovation where THC and these gummies are all now being introduced. What people do not understand is that the traditional form of consumption, whether being smoking, is different than eating. Eating multiplies the THC or the psychoactive ingredient in marijuana 10 times more than when you smoke it. And so that in itself is a whole different scenario. The other part of that, think about our city this morning and how many people across the city are probably smoking, and figure out how many of them that we're going to have to call an ambulance for, probably none. Whereas you have one incident at a school where gummies or these edibles are being consumed, and you have a need for 7 ambulances one time. And so when you realize the toll that it will take on your infrastructure, if only you see that there's a major difference in what we're dealing with as a community.
And adults are partaking in this more than ever, it seems.
Well,
and some are very proud of this fact. This must be very challenging for the council to get those messages across.
What we find very challenging at this time is getting the general public to realize that these new approaches are not safer. They're masked as being safer because, for example, vaping, it is said that you do not smell the traditional scent. There is this flavored scent that's left behind versus the traditional form of scent. But people do not understand that vaping, again, is 10 times more harmful to the body than traditional form of smoking. Same as eating. You're not smelling a smoking scent. And again, it's doing 10 times more of the harm to the body than the traditional form of smoking. And so that in itself, it would help to keep this behavior going, because people end up with different perceptions of it, not truly knowing the truth.
My goodness. Wow. All right. Let's get our audience in on this as well. Let's hear from you, your questions or concerns. 323-6232-325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. I want to go back to the gummies in school, though, and the packaging that often looks so much like other candies, mm-hmm, other mm-hmm. products out there, and that perhaps is causing some confusion for people. Let's talk about the challenge that presents and what people need to be looking out for and keeping in mind.
Go ahead.
Okay, so of course we know the packaging looks so very similar, but we can note all of the packages have a little bud or a little marijuana plant in the corner. There's something about the packaging that makes you know that it really isn't what it proposes to be. It's not the regular candy.
That's a pun inspection.
Right. Well, exactly.
That's like a pun inspection. You have to inspect the packet. Just jumped in the car with a normal pack of M&Ms or Skittles. But look closely. Let me say to your kids, let me see what this looks like.
Mm. Also, we have to also note the price is not the same. So whereas you can get a package of gummies for 50 cents or 75 cents, sorry, inflation, a dollar now. The packages are like $5 or $10. So that's another difference, in the pricing. Also, parents have to be cognizant. Ask your children, what is it you're getting? Look at look at stuff. This all boils down to parents being so very involved in their children's lives, where they know what it is they're doing, who it is they're with, what it is they're getting. You know, have the conversations. And I think in our society, you know, children are to be seen and not heard, or I can slap you side your head or whatever have you. But I think this is the time that parents really need to have that conversations with their children on these matters that are of so vital importance.
Mm-hmm. Yep. No? No. Getting an interesting text here. Someone says, if the government would legalize marijuana, then it can heavily regulate and get from trusted, safe, secure sources products, I guess, that aren't laced. We are hurting ourselves by denying progress. Most of the studies show that when consumed from around 18 years and up, marijuana and its products are not harmful for most.
Let me just say, it's not even a fact of something being laced. We haven't even gone into that. It is the fact that these items are made with so much more of the compound than a regular, as my colleague said earlier, a joint may have, what, 4 or 10 milligrams. Yeah. And then you have a gummy, which has 100 milligrams. So it's not the point of it being laced. When you're ingesting something that has a psychoactive component that is thousands of times more than the regular thing, then you're going to have a problem. And I think we're not thinking, we legalize marijuana and then we open up another Pandora box and can of worms. Mm-hmm. You know?
One of the challenges that I'm very keen about and working on now is this understanding that the human brain itself doesn't stop developing until the age of 25. Based on my research here at the council and usage among our youth population and age, you find that based on the global student health survey, you'll find that there are young people using from around the ages of 13, 14, and the effect that even lower than 13 and 14, but the effect that these substances now have on the brain development, we have to now question ourselves as leaders in the society when it comes to rehabilitating the behaviors of young people in understanding how their brains are being impacted by the use of these substances. So here you have a teacher trying to educate her students and saying, oh, y'all ain't listening, y'all ain't learning, y'all ain't this and y'all ain't that and y'all ain't the next thing. And a lot of this stuff is because these kids are some substances and thereby it's affecting the ability for their brain to function and do the cognitive thinking skills that it ought to do. And so it's having to look at all these different approaches when you're talking about dealing with our population and dealing with the rehabilitation of our people. And so it's these aspects of it that are so important to the council and the Ministry of Health. Hence, we have the wellness unit now about the state of our Bahamian people.
Let's take this call. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Hi. Good morning.
Hi.
First time caller.
Welcome.
Yes. Thank you. I'm sorry if this was addressed already, but I'm just tuning in. But you had mentioned the guest had mentioned that vaping was much worse than regular smoking. If he can just explain why for me, and also the vaping, I understand that the flavors are used in the vape, they can be nicotine versus nicotine free. Is that correct? I'll hang up and listen. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Briefly, because I know our time is limited. One of the stark differences in vaping and again the traditional forms of smoking is the residue that would come out from a vape is considered an aerosol that will fall onto the surface of the environment that it's in. So if you're vaping in the front room, it's unseen to the natural eye. That's an aerosol that actually coats the surfaces of whatever environment that it's in. Versus the traditional form of smoking that evaporates into the air. With vaping, you'll have what you call third-hand smoke, meaning I could have just vaped into a room and someone can enter that room, and by virtue of them touching the surfaces, they're now in contact with the very same substances that I would have been using versus the traditional form of smoking. And I can't remember what the second part of her question was. But yeah, vaping and traditional forms of smoking, based on our research, it's considered to be worse. And just looking at the death toll related to traditional forms of smoking worldwide has increased by agencies that we gather statistics and data from.
Yeah. Noticing that people don't have the same reaction to people vaping. I was shocked a few years back right here. Somebody was vaping right in the movie theater. And I'm like, wait, this can't be right. And nobody said anything to this person, but people feel they can do that.
It's because it's a lack of knowledge, a lack of understanding. And so that's why here at the council, we're trying to raise awareness about the usage of these things and how it affects our bodies and the individuals around us. With traditional form of smoking, it goes as far as, I think, secondhand smoke. Whereas with vaping, it goes as far as third-hand smoke. That's adding another challenge to an already prevalent problem. And so it can't be safer. One of the things that we've started to do in our awareness is sort of create engaging campaigns. And so during the drug month, one of the activities that we've been very excited about has been our art competition, where we engaged all of our high schools here in the Bahamas, both private and public. And I had days where you had art teachers or guidance counselors would call and say, this is a day that the child was not supposed to be at school. But because of this activity, they're here investing in their time and energies. And so what we realize is that if we find new ways to engage our young people or just the society in general about the use of these things and the knowledge thereby, we believe that that's when we can start to see some change. And for example, with our art competition, we had required there to be an individual, set. But down at Claridge Primary, we had a set of children spend elaborate time. They produced a whole banner that looked like something you wouldn't believe. And so we encourage people to go to the Bahamas National Drug Council's Facebook page, where they can see a lot of the work that we're doing and a lot of the engagement that we get from young people and how we're able to help. Just on Saturday, we were able, and I'll let Ms. Anderson speak more to it, on Saturday we were able to provide some intervention for 345 students through the YIP program. And so constantly we're out there banging the pavement, trying to get the message out and raise awareness amongst our people on the use of these substances.
Anton, I'm going to allow you to do that in just a second. We want to take this call and then we want to take a break, and we can pick it up if you can on the other side of the break. Let's take this call. Good morning, caller. You're on the air.
Good morning, Dwight. Good morning to your guests. Good morning, Bahamas. Now, Dwight, the lady, I think, said that if we leave, it will open up Pandora's box. Now, I'd like to ask, when they studied other countries that legalized the marijuana, what did they notice? What type of Pandora boxes? Hello?
Dwight, you want me to take that?
Yes, please.
I think we have this mindset, let's do what everybody else is doing. What's good for the goose isn't necessarily good for the gander. And so why can't we be true and authentic? Why do we have to follow fashion? Why do we want to follow the lead of somebody else? We already know that there are serious issues in our country, set aside from everything else that's going on. So do we want to add to it? Or do we want to be true and authentic and make our country somewhere that is admired because we did not follow the crowd?
I want to use, for example, caller, a real-life scenario that we face at the Drug Council currently without any listed narcotic substances haven't become legal or for medicinal use. This is before that even happens. You have a situation here in the Bahamas where we have a problem with stigmas. And when I say stigmas, if you tell somebody to go and see a counselor, they say, oh, ain't nothing wrong with me. And so thereby, treatment becomes difficult now. In a case where, for example, marijuana is not legal or for medicinal use in the Bahamas, we have individuals that we see are in clear need of treatment, and in our attempt to provide them some sort of treatment intervention, there's so much stigma attached to it. And so until we can be truly educated as a people and informed, empowered, and understand the uses and misuses of these substances, I don't know where the government is on the legalization of it. As a council, we are encouraged to keep our personal opinions out of the day-to-day workings of it. But it's understanding the challenges that currently exist. We have young people that are already on wards in SRC, Sandlands Rehabilitation Center. We have young people that are on wards at PMH from the use of tobacco products with these substances. And so the challenge we face when you legalize it is how more prevalent will it become? And so those are the concerns versus this thing where everybody seems to think that once, you know, you go legal, all of a sudden you start making money. And if you, when I research some of that aspect of it in other jurisdictions, a lot of the proposed benchmarks that they say that they're going to make, a lot of them do not make. And so I'm not, me for one, won't do it just for the sake of making money, you know.
All right, we're going to take a break. When we come back, more on this, we're talking with Antoinette Anderson and Mandel Miller with the Bahamas National Drug Council. It is National Substance Abuse Prevention Month. We're going to talk about alcohol and the role parents are playing in creating some of these challenges, and we've got a lot of text messages as well. Stick around. This is Morning Blend. Stay with us.
Around the world, Cleveland Clinic is recognized as a leader in healthcare. Our team of experts relentlessly pursues the best for our patients. From groundbreaking cancer research to state-of-the-art heart surgery, life-saving innovations happen here every day. When it's time to travel for your health, it's time to travel to Cleveland Clinic. Your destination for care, for the world. To learn more, visit clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
One thing there is no debate about is that BTC has the best rates. Now, the best rates just got better because you pay half the price of the other guys with your BTC home internet and mobile services combined. Switching to BTC is a no-brainer because I pay less with BTC and get super fast internet with speeds up to 600 megs. The other guys, their internet only go up to 105 megs.
Get all the internet you want at half the price when you bundle your home internet and mobile. Visit a BTC store to make the switch today. Conditions apply.
We believe in relationship banking. We take pride in getting to know our clients. You have access to knowledgeable, approachable ambassadors and financial coaches so that we can recommend the best product for you. At Fidelity, we care about you, physical health. We can relate to you because we're just like you. Come and start your relationship banking experience with us today. Visit us online at fidelitygroup.com. Visit any of our branches in Nassau or Grand Bahama, or phone 356-7764 in Nassau, or 352-6676 for Freeport.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
Earning zero interest on your savings at the bank? With as little as $100, you can start earning interest on your money while you're sleeping, eating, or standing in line at the bank with the CFELD Savings Express Plan. Ready to invest? Start by putting $1,000 into our mutual funds and earn interest there too. Because at CFAL, your interest is our interest. Visit CFAL.com to start now. CFAL, growing wealth for future generations of Bahamians.
This is Guardian 8.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
No more. I'm tired of waking up on the floor.
Tennessee-o. He smiled because I did not understand. Then he held out some moonshine whiskey-o. He said it was the best in all the land. And I said, no, 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 I don't drink it no more. I'm tired of waking up on the floor. No, thank you, it makes me sneeze. And then it makes it hard to find a door.
We are back here with Morning Blend on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strachan along with Chester Robards. We are talking with the Bahamas National Drug Council, Antoinette Anderson and Mandel Miller. It is National Substance Abuse Prevention Month. That song there, the No No song by Ringo Starr, you know, it's a fun song, but it's about cocaine and marijuana and drinking. And that one's a novelty type song. But there are other very popular pop songs that today, we've for decades been hearing rappers, singers, everybody just blatantly, some are hiding it, but blatantly talking about drug use and alcohol use and abuse. Is that creating a problem, especially with young people who say, well, hey, everybody's doing it?
Yes, it is. To be frank, yes, in its simplest form. And it's because socially has a huge effect, and it's a huge part of our youth population in particular. Something that we took very keen note of is it's either at the beginning of this school semester or at the beginning of the school year, we saw a circulation of videos among our school populations where alcohol use seemed social. And so everybody was just shooting a video of a half point here, a half point there, some rum they sneaking in, some rum they sneaking there. Wow. And it goes to show you how the social media world or platforms are having a serious impact and an effect on our population. And so, again, the answer to your question is in fact, yes. Beyond just the drug use, we've seen this spilling over into the use of violence, particularly among our young people. We've seen here in the Bahamas now portraying these acts of violence and producing similar like videos within their social sets that are creating challenges. I'm aware of incidents that are currently being investigated by our armed forces, where the use of these such videos produced by young people here in our society are up for evidence. And so, yes, the answer to that question is yes. And again, at the council, we're encouraging parents to become more proactive in understanding what their kids are involved in. For example, our kids would come home from school, go into their rooms, and they're on their laptops. You know, we feel like once they're outside getting in no trouble, they're good. But, you know, there's a lot of virtual trouble out there that they can get into that manifest in real-time problems for them when they either go to school or do go out in the community that you'll be surprised of. And so we have to be more proactive in what's going on with the young people. I had a situation where parents said, my child is just, she's be tired from school and this and that. So she come home from school and just go into the room and go to sleep, not realizing that that's related to the use of some substance that she later found out. And so I encourage parents to be very proactive. The old people say, be careful for nothing, Dwight.
Wow. All right. We're going to break for news headlines. When we come back, we're going to pick this up in Morning Blend Business. We want to talk about substance abuse in the workplace, if we're having any issues there. And I guess that might be more alcohol related. I don't know.
Again, we got to break them stigmas, Dwight. People got to speak up. Co-workers got to say. Somebody got to say something.
Because some people act kind of...
Dwight might stagger into the studio and I need to call the boss and say, hey, look, we got to send Dwight up the road by the Bahamas National Drug Council.
Oh, indeed. Boy, we're getting to that after the break and more on alcohol. We're talking with the Bahamas National Drug Council and it is next month having a great conversation with Antoinette Anderson and Mandel Miller. We'll pick it up after this. Stay with us.
That's another second. Around the world, Cleveland Clinic is recognized as a leader in healthcare. Our team of experts relentlessly pursues the best for our patients.
From groundbreaking cancer research to state-of-the-art heart surgery, life-saving innovations happen here every day. When it's time to travel for your health, it's time to travel to Cleveland Clinic, your destination for care, for every care in the world. To learn more, visit clevelandclinic.org/Caribbean.
When you're hunting for your first home, it can feel like a lot.
With RBC by your side, your home-owning journey can be stress-free. An RBC Mobile Mortgage Specialist will meet you almost anywhere, and you'll benefit from flexible repayment terms, costs, and cashback where it matters. Pre-qualify to see what you can afford. Start at rbc.com/Caribbean/mortgages. Limited time offer.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
What happened? The Breakfast Lady ran out of tune in, Gretzky.
We need to start joking about everything, you know. This serious, boy. This real serious, boy.
But it was serious. Tell me.
All right, well, today, boss gave us, boy, one big, big contract. And nobody else get a chance and nobody say nothing.
Boy, you know that ain't right. You know government contracts ain't supposed to go that way.
Yeah, but nobody's saying nothing. Boss man just tell people to sign the papers. Then he sent me to meet his boy downtown and collect this envelope.
You need to tell somebody. You need to become a whistleblower.
You know I's a real man, but I never blow no whistle. I be drunk all my life in Junkano.
No way. A whistleblower is someone who tells people what they see when they see something wrong happening at work.
But I ain't no whistleblower, and I ain't no snitch. I still wait there, you know.
But ain't nobody gonna know it's you. All you gotta do is call Crime Stoppers, or you could text them from inside the Crack Crime Bahamas app. They don't ask about you, and your call goes straight through to Miami, so nobody know you is. And if you text, your message get mixed up like Kong Salad.
Call 328-8477 from Nassau, or 242-300-8477 from the Family Islands.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9. Fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
Wake up, today. Wake up, it's a new day.
Welcome to Morning Blend Business on this Wednesday, March 30th, 2022. Welcome back to our Morning Blend listeners. Once again, I'm Dwight Strachan, along with Chester Robards. And this morning, we continue our conversation with the Bahamas National Drug Council. As it is National Substance Abuse Prevention Month, we are having a great conversation with Antoinette Anderson and Mandel Miller. And as this hour has a business focus, let's talk about substance abuse in the workplace. I know you focus mainly on speed. You're getting reports? Are you hearing? Is this on the rise where workers are showing up high or drunk or vaping excessively? Or what are we seeing out there?
Okay, so what we're seeing at this time is agencies coming together and having us come and give talks on various aspects of drug use and its effects for their staff, whether it be the general staff or selected staff who they may know have issues, who they are wanting to think about going into treatment. And so sometimes you just can't come out and say, you gotta go. You got to go into treatment. You have to have to use a roundabout way to get them to want to go into treatment. So we've been to several government agencies. I am not going to name them. Talks on the use of drugs, the use of alcohol, stress-related issues, how to deal with stress, how to cope with stress. I know last year we did something with all of the law enforcement agency, all of the uniform branches on alcohol and drugs. So we're getting the word out there. I just wanted to say, as far as our month is concerned, what we did was we have several initiatives specifically for the schools, and I know you wanted to get out of schools. One is Link Me, the other is I Totally Matter, and the third is The Best Me is Drug Free. Now, this particular initiative was just held last week, and it afforded the senior students, public schools that it was given to, they were afforded community service hours. So we are doing all that we can, one, not only to get the word out there, but to get our students involved and get them understanding what is happening. You can, if you could get it at the root, then the tree has a better viability and growth. So we're trying to get it from the root, but we are out there in the different agencies. We are open to speak at private companies as well. So it's just not for the government agencies, but for private Bahamas as well, to have us come in, have us meet with your staff, have us speak to your staff about these dangers and about what they can do, where they can go, and how they can gain help if there are any issues.
Mm-hmm. I have a question on the policy about drug testing in the country. I don't know if there is one, if businesses use it a lot. I know when I worked in the States, it was like before you could get the job, you had to do a drug test. And then, you know, their policy was random drug testing. You could be called anytime to be drug tested. What's that like here?
Okay, so there isn't any specific policy on drug testing. What I do know is in the police force, I think they're going to re-sign. There's a drug test, but to say in all of the government agencies, there isn't a mandatory drug testing. I don't think that would be a good thing if there were, because
no.
Yeah. I was gonna say
I'm smiling saying that because I'm thinking, boy, if you start to do random drug tests, plenty of people ain't gonna be working no more.
So
I smiled. I'm thinking to myself and just smiling and saying, boy, I don't know if that'll be a good thing to do right now, you know.
Well, I thought the same thing, so don't feel bad.
Okay.
Well, what we've seen happening, Dwight, in the workplace is we've seen human resource managers. When they encounter an individual or two within the work staff that they find that could possibly be a challenge, like Ms. Anderson would have alluded to, instead of just pinpointing that person or also understanding the stigmas related to treatment, what we found human resource managers doing is, okay, there's a problem with this individual, so let's put on a health symposium for all staff members and thereby sit around this person. And it helps to create some sort of support system for them also, because they know that what their challenge is, and they end up finding themselves in an event or a situation where other people around them are there to support them, per se, with whatever their situation is. And so it's that approach that we see working, and we encourage corporate Bahamas to continue to do more of that. And like Ms. Anderson said, in the last year or so, we did a lot of work with our armed forces, realizing that our armed forces in the last 2 to 3 years, particularly dealing with the pandemic and post-Dorian, have been really stressed, and their jobs in itself is a very stressful job. And so if you have family members in those armed forces that you know battle with any kind of substance, alcohol is a substance that can be a challenge, please encourage them to come and see us, or you as a family member, friend, or loved one can reach out to us in some respectful way to provide some sort of intervention for that person, because we do see it and we do encourage people and we do know that they have challenges going for the treatment based on stigmas.
Dwight, let me just add here, our this month is Better Health Through Better Partnerships.
Yes.
And I think we pulled that in because we do understand that it takes a village, whether it's with our children or with adults, it does take a village to get things done. And so that's what we want to do. We incorporate that village mentality.
Mm-hmm. Going back to what you said earlier about random drug testing, but perhaps it should be based on the job. If you're doing something that requires heavy equipment or if you're driving, maybe that should be the case there. We're getting a text asking, I would like to know what is being done to crack down on bus drivers drinking on the job. Uh-oh. Some would gather together to sip on their lunch break, then go back on the road. even though the average drink, the drinking can be a personal habit. When operating a public service vehicle, better discipline should be involved.
You know, Dwight, we talk about these things haphazardly as a society, but let's go back to our referendum or the referendums we have had in relation to women in our country. The reason I use those things as an example is we talk a good game, but when it comes down, when it boils down to us doing the necessary actions to provide change in policy, we as a people or as a society haven't proven to have taken it that far. Mm-hmm. The reality of it is that when someone starts to, that conversation sounds very good nationally on the surface right now, that we should do mandatory drug testing for all of our public service drivers and different people operating heavy equipments and so forth. But now, if you were to talk about making that a law or a policy, and people now have to think about the reality of their daddy, uncle, cousin, brother, this one and the next one, who they know use illegal substances or have challenges being tested, people are going to opt to say, no, I want that law, I want that policy. And so we have to be about our approach to dealing with things as a people. And we must understand our approach will either provide us some progress or keep us back. And we just have to know what we want as a future. I would want a safer, healthier Bahamas. And so thereby, I would opt to see a policy like that take place. Someone may say, I don't want to see my uncle not have a job or not go to jail or not have any consequences as a result of use of these substances, so I don't support that policy. So that's what it all boils down to at the end of the day, sir.
Yeah. Folks, call in 323-6232. 325-4316, 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. And we're talking with Antoinette Anderson and Mandel Miller with the Bahamas National Drug Council. All right, so we got this text earlier. They're saying, not to be that person, but THC snacks are coming from the parents. Children aren't buying the weed Cheetos from the street vendors, and the people who are selling it wouldn't risk getting arrested selling it to kids. Well, I don't know. Alcohol, no sensible bar will sell a pint to a child, even if they know it's for the child's mother. So I guess they're saying the parents need to take responsibility for what we're seeing when it comes to youth substance abuse. What say you on that? That, you know, we keep telling people to practice what we, do as I say, but not as I do. But can that work when you are around your parents or all the adults in your life just constantly getting high or drunk?
I wouldn't necessarily say that parents are giving their children Cheetos or snacks. I won't say that they're not giving their children the marijuana infused snacks.
They're getting them from their cupboard. They're going in the mom's
what
stash.
What I will say is no matter what, our children are getting it and it's causing a problem. So let's get to the root of the problem. If it's the parents, then we need to deal with the parents. I am of the firm belief that during the season, be parents to their children in every aspect, in every avenue, in every way, because that is very necessary. As far as alcohol, brother, I was going to say something just now, but I will leave that for in my brain and not on the radio.
What? No, man. Don't
no.
do that. Come on, answer that. You got
to
say
I'm trying to get in trouble, though. Uh-oh. Because alcohol, I find in certain communities, there are certain stores that the little child could be standing outside and some junes are outside and say, go buy this for me. And the junes say, I give you $2 and you could get the $2 and you can buy that for the child.
Yep.
Or there are certain stores that a child could go in under the guise of purchasing something else and can purchase alcohol. And so I'll just leave it at that.
You know, we need to speak it because that is absolutely happening. They're not even supposed to be in liquor stores. And I've seen quite a few children
Since we're here, something that we're gonna tell the Bahamas to look out for, liquor store, liquor business, sell alcohol, Look forward to seeing the National Drug Council come to your place of business, contact you, because we are getting ready to roll out a campaign where it's all about reinforcing the law of not selling alcohol to our young people. If you look at how many, I'll just throw out there, for example, how many Chinese stores we have where there's a restaurant and liquor being sold at the same time. So here you now run the risk of a child saying, I come to buy shrimp, fry, something, but at the same time, alcohol is being served from that very same counter, location, cash register. These things present challenges. And so we have to know now, how are we going to deal with them as a country moving forward?
Wow, my goodness. All right, let's take this call. Good morning, caller. You're on Morning Blend Business.
Good morning, Dwight. And yes, I think we are probably too far gone on this marijuana thing, because it is such a weed break. It's a normal thing. And it shocked me, having lived in the States, mind to be fired in a heartbeat because you're a random drug test. If you drive a forklift in a man warehouse, you ain't gonna cause no accident to have him sued. You got a random drug test. Any job, even you driving a public bus and you high, it's the same as being drunk. Your judgment is clouded. That marijuana goes to your frontal lobe, especially if you smoke marijuana as a little young child. Your brain is damaged. Your frontal lobe is damaged. You make bad decisions, bad judgment. You join gangs. And you know why you're doing it? Because your frontal lobe is damaged. You are what you call an LD. You just, because marijuana really has destroyed the black community in the States and here. You make bad decisions. You can't learn. You can't remember nothing. Just if you just Google THC effect on the frontal lobe.
Okay. All right. Thank you very much.
We need more informed citizens like him. We need more people using Google. And when we say informed, even if his information isn't all 100% accurate or correct, at least that citizen has some idea that these substances leave some lasting effect, negative effect on the brain and the body as a result of usage. We need more of that in our communities.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so... Dwight, if you don't mind, let me stick a pin. Like we said, we had an art competition. Mm-hmm. And so on our 242 Bahamas National Drug Council page, we did post our winners. But I want to do it here for the entire Bahamas to know
Welcome
that
back.
We had some really good artwork. You can go on our page. The artwork is there. Our winners were, our third place winner was Jay Roll from Aquinas College. She got 374 votes. Second place winner was Brooke Stewart from Xavier's Lower School. Her artwork garnered 506 votes. Mm-hmm. And our first place winner was Kaylee Roll from Aquinas College. Her artwork garnered 546 votes. I need you all to go on the page and look at the pieces we got.
Congratulate these young people.
We are so excited. Our theme was the best me. Not the best me is drug free. What's the theme for
the
that?
Best me is drug free.
Yeah. Or how I look drug free. Okay. This is drug free looks like me.
You
got
to excuse us. That's why we're running so many different programs. Matter. This, like, we lose it some days. We come into office and are we talking to today? Who's the audience?
That's good. Yeah. You all are busy. That's wonderful. That's wonderful.
The
getting the message
was,
out there.
Drug free looks like me for the art competition. And so it gave our children the opportunity to say, this is what me being drug-free looks like. And that's really what we're trying to hammer in, what drug-free looks like to our children, so that they grow up with the thought knowing that they are too good for drugs, that they can be drug-free, that they can live productive lives that do not encompass them using substances that can diminish their productivity. So that's what we're all about.
At the council, Dwight, we've realized that drug use is an alternative to some challenge that's going on in the human life. And so what we try to do at the council is come up with smart or healthy alternatives for persons to turn to. For example, when we talked about the webinars that we would have done for our armed forces, you know, it's a matter of coming up with healthy for individuals to partake in versus these vices that that have more negative effects on us. And so we encourage people to find things that they love doing that are healthy and are beneficial to the overall aspect of their life versus partaking in a behavior that only diminishes your quality of life.
Yeah. All right. I think this is a call here. Let's take this. Good morning, caller. You're on Morning Blend Business. Are you there? Did we lose you? No. Okay. This text here then. How do I tell my 17-year-old daughter that smoking weed is not right when her Grammy smokes cigarettes and her uncle smokes weed freely at home?
I would say a minor child, because 17 is still considered a minor, should not even be around anybody smoking. Yeah. Mm-hmm. That shouldn't even happen.
As a society, we have, I think the benchmarks or the landmarks is what I say, have changed. One time ago, young men were not encouraged to be around the older guys in the community when they were partaking in whether it was drinks or smokes. They were encouraged to go off and play with their peers. Whereas today, young people are more being lured into and encouraged to partake in these kinds of activities. And so understanding how these dynamics have shifted, we as a society now must stand up and do what's necessary to protect our future generations of young people and who will eventually become older people, which is make up our society. And so we have to stand up and be that change and make that difference. I'll use, for example, I came out of the house just recently out of my home, and I live across the street from a barber shop. And four young men are gathered in a huddle, you know, just going over something. And I'm like, what are y'all doing? And I realized that they're actually sitting on a main street in the front of a barbershop, hiding, which ain't hiding, which didn't make no sense, to roll up a joint. And I'm like, what are y'all doing? These aren't my kids. I don't know them from the man on the moon. But my thing to them was, y'all don't know if somebody who's going to look at your scholarship application or your next job interview application whenever you is riding past seeing you involved in this kind of behavior. And they said, but that makes sense, Jerry. We wasn't even thinking about that. And so the onus is on us as a society to stand up and be about change in the dynamics of what we see taking place of our country. Being in here in the business section of it, I say to young men out there that are involved in the sale of illegal narcotics. For example, at one point I cleaned vehicles, and I realized during that time that it's equivalent to the same money that I'm making, that the guy making who's selling a $5 or $10 bag of narcotics, and it doesn't have the overhead concerns of somebody coming to kill me because I'm operating a legal business, which is cleaning vehicles. And so it's being able to go into the community as an outreach officer and sit down with a young man who's selling narcotics and say and show him, like really map it out for him, that at the end of the week, we coming out with the same thing, buddy, and I got far less risk than you got, who got to carry a gun, who got to watch where you sleep, who got to be running from the police and all these different things. And it's helping our people understand the shift in the dynamics. And what we need to revert back to is where we see transformation being possible.
Wow. All right. We only have a couple minutes left. Tell us how people with the Bahamas National Drug Council and what we need to know if we want to assist or contribute to your work and your efforts.
Okay, so the Bahamas National Drug Council is located number 11 Village Road in the Eugene Cooper Building. We are right across the road from
Kalina
Insurance. Our phone numbers are 397-8550. We are on Facebook, 242 Bahamas National Drug Council. We are a referral agency, so if someone needs help, we can provide referral assistance to you, to our various partners, stakeholders in the field, for you to get the help that you need. schools, corporate Bahamas, government agencies,
churches,
call us. We are available to come in for talks. Used Zoom extensively over the last 2 years, so it's good to get back in a position where we're actually out there and seeing people and meeting them face to face and working with them. We have various programs. We can tailor a program depending on your needs. We are quite capable of doing that. Our team is excited. We are ready to go. We are ready to ensure that our country is drug-free. We know that we're not going to get everybody, but if we can limit, then that's our thing.
And Dwight, I heard you allude to people being able to partner with us. This precious work that we're doing at the Bahamas National Drug Council of trying to heal and provide healing for our country is forever in need of resources. That we can never have enough resources to do things. And so from time to time, you'll find that the council will write to corporate Bahamas asking for assistance. For example, when we're doing them, but as the art competition, we're looking for stuff to reward these deserving young people with. And so if there's anybody under the sound of my voice right now, I have a school, Claridge Primary, who did a phenomenal, an exceptional, outstanding job within this month of activity that I need to provide them with 3 tablets. And so if anybody under the sound of our voice can contact the council and provide us with those 3 tablets to provide those deserving young people and that institution down there to show those kids that we love them and we believe in creating an environment for them to be drug-free, please reach out to the Bahamas National Drug Council and say that you want to be a partner with us. In whatever your business is, please, we're very interested in partnering with the business community so that we can provide our young people and the society with the resources that we need that lead to healing and treatment and prevention.
Yeah. Let's take this call before we go. We've got a couple of messages that came in late that I actually want you to respond to. Caller, good morning. You're on the... Hi, good morning. You're live on the... Hi, caller, good morning. We can hear you. We can hear something. Did they put us on hold? Well, okay. There we go. Hi. Good morning. You're on the air. Yeah, turn down your radio for us, please. Turn down your radio. Okay. There we go. Are you ready? What's happening? No. Okay. This text here. Wonderful show. I understand the purpose of the conversation and support it, but what is to be said about the people who are responsible users and function well in everyday environments? I'm speaking about adults. Well, I mean, I'll let you respond, but I mean, we were talking about substance abuse, right? So if you are responsibly using, I mean, hopefully it's not an illegal substance, but responsibly using it, that's different from substance abuse. But Antoinette, Mandel, you respond to that,
yeah,
please.
That's like a trick question. Oh, well, I'm being responsible, so there's not a problem with me.
Is it, but how can you be responsible with an illegal substance?
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. But if we are specifically talking about the use and misuse, because mm-hmm. you technically can't abuse drugs. You abuse a child, you abuse animals, but you misuse these substances, which causes problems. So that's specifically what we were talking about.
Yeah. And if it becomes an addiction, of course, we've got a whole other set of problems there. Yes. Yeah.
Exactly.
This one here, cannabis is good as medicine. It is not good as a crutch. It is healthier and safer than alcohol or cigarettes as a vice, but the way we use it culturally is not healthy. We have people with addictive personalities abusing a non-addictive plant to run away from their problems. We need proper regulation.
Yes,
okay. I agree with the proper regulation.
I agree mm-hmm. with that. I'm a proponent of the decriminalization, because those things help the development of our society. I'm not one that's running behind it to say it's going to be a good injection of revenue per se. No, when you look around, I just came from Las Vegas. There's an increase in the amount of vagrants in the city as a result of these kinds of narcotics being considered legal or there being a slap on the wrist for it. Outside of major hotels, there are any number of vagrants, and I don't think that is something that we want to see persist here in the Bahamas. We already have challenges, and we have to be careful about how we go about further development.
Absolutely. This has been a great conversation. We have to have you back, and not just during National Substance Abuse Prevention Month. But
anytime, Dwight, anytime. Yes.
Wonderful. Anthony Anderson you. And Mandel Miller. Thank you. Thank you both so
thank
much.
Thank you so much.
All right, we're going to take a break and be back with Radio 96.9.
She said it was the best in all the land. And I said, no, 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 I don't smoke it no more. I'm tired of waking up on the floor. No, thank you, please, it only makes me sneeze. Then it makes it hard to find the door. A woman that I know just came from Mallorca, Spain. She smiled because I did not understand. Then she held out a 10-pound bag of cocaine. She said it was the finest in the land. And I said, no, 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 I don't.
How important collecting your money can be to the success of your business. Start your relationship with Fidelity today so that we can show you the many options available to you with our merchant services, from click and pay to merchant terminals and e-commerce options. We're here to help your business succeed. For more details, speak to one of our business development officers at 356-7764 in Nassau or 352-6676 in Freeport. Visit our website at fidelitygroup.com or visit any of our branches.
Fidelity, we're good for you.
It is time for your morning business report, brought to you by CFAL. The Attorney General's office and lawyers from the Grand Bahama Port Authority have been in contact over the continuing vexing issue of how to move forward with demolishing abandoned and dilapidated structures in Freeport that have stood as an eyesore in the city for years. Minister of Grand Bahama Ginger Moxie telling reporters that this is a priority issue for the government as it works out ways to create more opportunities and entice more investors to put money on the ground in Grand Bahama. Attorney General Ryan Pinder recently said the derelict buildings are becoming a crisis for downtown Nassau as the country's laws are strong enough to deal with buildings that have been left to sit abandoned and decaying. But the relationship between the Port Authority, the Grand Bahama Port Authority, and the city of Freeport is different from the government's relationship with the country's capital. In the Freeport bylaws, Section 3, the GBPA can only take recourse if a building is a health or structural hazard. Governments have continued to work on improving Grand Bahama, which was once the premier destination for visitors in the country. Moxie saying yesterday that as cruise lines invest in the island, the government is attempting to create opportunities for Bahamians in the orange or creative economy as well. Read more about that in today's Guardian Business section. With rising fuel costs impacting every sector of the economy, the government will have to scale back on its capital works plans or find more creative ways to get its projects done. That's according to interim president of the Bahamian Contractors Association, Leonard Sands. This week, gas prices hit an all-time high of $6.33, with diesel at $5.25. Industry experts are saying that these are the highest fuel prices in the capital in more than 15 years. Sandwich in the pockets, the government is bound to face even steeper price increases. He says gas prices are going up, which means that the cost of producing things is going to rise as well, and that it is too early and hasn't affected material costs here yet, but expect that to happen because many local suppliers are still drawing down on supplies they've purchased before the war in Ukraine started. He says when that supply is depleted, prices are going to go up because it's going to cost more to produce the same product, and then infrastructural costs will increase. The government announcing its intention to sign a $9 million non-reimbursable financing agreement facilitated through the European Union Caribbean Investment Facility, which will be used to promote solar technology nationally. Minister of Economic Affairs Michael Halkidis and Works and Utilities Minister Alfred Sears are expected to sign the grant agreement. And with a representative of the IDB acting as administrator under the Financial Framework Partnership Agreement between the European Union today, is broken down into three components. Specifically, more than $8 million will be spent under the first component to promote reliable and renewable energy in New Providence and the Family Islands through the adoption of resilient solar photovoltaic technology. And additionally, 340 plus thousand was expected to be spent on developing local skills for services related to solar PV generation systems. The final component covers other administrative costs associated with the grant. And the Bahamas will be the first country in the region to utilize the Food and Agriculture Organization's Food Control System Assessment Tool to ensure that the country is properly prepared in food safety and public health, and has a structured and bolstered system for agricultural trade practices and food resilience. More than 30 stakeholders were recently trained in the assessment during a workshop organized by the FAO and the Bahamas Agricultural Health and Food Safety Authority. The Minister of Agriculture, Marine Resources, and Family Island Affairs has attended a number of international fora recently as the country prepares to take a stand against food insecurity. Overseas, Poland announcing steps today to end all Russian oil imports by year's end, while Germany issued a warning about natural gas levels and called on people to conserve. New signs of how Russia's war in Ukraine has escalated tensions about securing energy supplies to power Europe. Poland, which has taken in millions of Ukrainian refugees, has taken the lead in the European Union on swiftly cutting off Russian fossil fuels. The 27-nation bloc has declined to sanction energy because it depends on Moscow for the fuel needed for cars, electricity, heating, and industry. But it has announced proposals to wean itself off those supplies. This is all coming a day after Poland said it was banning Russian coal import. Poland will take steps to become independent of Russian supplies and calling on other European countries to walk away as well, urging that money paid for Russia's oil and gas is fueling its war machine. In your Market Watch, recapping trading on the BSIX from Tuesday, your market movers, Doctors Hospital moving 400 shares, closing unchanged at $10.10. Consolidated Water unchanged at $2.08. And Emira Incorporated unchanged at 1184 rather. The BSIX All Share Index closing at 2,299.07, unchanged. That's your Market Watch. And that is your morning business report brought to you by CFAL, growing wealth for future generations.
This traffic report is brought to you by Shield Insurance and Prudential.
As we got closer to 9 o'clock this morning, we saw some improvements in the traffic flow throughout the city. Some of the thoroughfares out here. West Gate West did well, gaining traffic out of both Classen Road and Somalapapa Highway in a timely manner. Six-leg roundabout got stacked, but that's doing well. Much improved, too. And even Living Carmichael Road improved, because that was being held up a lot by the congestion on Blue Hill Road itself. But now getting over the hill of Blue Hill Road is a whole lot better, with the traffic on both sides of the roundabout, Tony's Million Darling West Lane and Independence Drive West Lane, so you've got a better flow. As you head along Blue Hill Road and get through the Robinson Road roundabout, it's a little bit welder due to the traffic, but it's not a consistent, lengthy hangup. It moves. So you still got a good ride along Blue Hill Road to get into the city. East Street has a similar look coming from the deep south. Minor slowdowns, but nothing to talk about. No congestions or delays. And for the remainder of the city, Marathon Road settled down now with the ride going in on the north lane into the city. Same thing with Soldier Road going into that intersection of Wolf Village and Bernard Road. Bernard Road traffic still heavy, but gradually getting out of there too. Same thing with the Eastern Road. A lot of that traffic getting out of there now. Early Street somewhat, at least in the stretch between Montague and Mackey Street. Once you get beyond Mackey Street, the ride into the downtown area, much improved. The ride coming from the west, minor slow-ups getting into the roundabout at Saunders Beach when you come from around the bend on West Bend. But you've got a slow ride along West Bay Street coming into the city. No real hang-ups, just a slow ride. It actually slows down more when you get closer to the downtown area. For what it's worth, the morning commute, pretty much over. This is National Traffic Report, a service of J.S. Johnson, the only insurance agents and brokers giving you peace of mind in the Bahamas for over 100 years. You can call them at 397-2100. That's 397-2100. 877-2100 for more info. AVAN.
Michael was in a horrible car accident. Prudential Loss Adjusters managed his claim and got him the settlement he deserved. Sierra's roof received hurricane damage. Thanks to Prudential, she and her kids are happy with their claim settlement. Tammy fractured her ankle in a slip and fall. Prudential saved her time, money, and peace of mind. Prudential are here for you whenever a tragedy strikes. Call 322-4026 now.
Don't wait for disaster to strike. This hurricane season, be ready. Protect your home with an affordable and comprehensive home insurance policy from Shield Insurance. You can't control what nature blows your way, but with Shield Insurance, you can rest easy as you ride out the storm. Protect your largest and most valuable investment. Don't take a chance. Put your home in our hands.
Shield Insurance agents and brokers in Nassau. Call 356-7202 or Freeport 352-5945.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Morning, Glenn Business on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strachan along with Chester Robards. Chester Robards is still with us. Oh, wonderful stuff. Your interesting story in the Guardian Business section today about Grand Bahama and their derelict building problem. So it's just amazing, the two largest cities in the country both having their share of problems when it comes to buildings. And my goodness, how did we get here? How did we get here? And what are we going to do? What are we going to do?
You know how we got here. We always talk about it all the time. Special interest groups, you know, money talks.
My goodness, wow. Yep, very disturbing, but we're going to keep watching this and keep on everybody. You're very low, by the way, Chester, very, very low. But we're going to keep putting the pressure on folks to act. We cannot continue this, and it shouldn't just be to attract investment. Of course, that's important, but do it for us. I mean, it is not a good feeling to drive around and see all of this in your city.
When you say attract investment, is concerned that it's causing the problem. Is that what you mean?
Right. That's what the guy got from the from your story. That seems to be. Yeah. They think that's turning away investors.
Yeah.
But yeah. Even if we had all the investors we needed, to have a bunch of abandoned buildings around, it's just ridiculous, insane. Yeah. All right, so you heard the junkie music because it really does appear, and honestly, with the numbers, the COVID numbers, there's no justification for why there couldn't be junkie in full earnest going forward. And so the junkie community getting ready for this and the opportunities that this will present and possible changes as well. For more on this, take a listen to this report from our Tashina Robinson.
The Junkanoo Corporation, New Providence, JCNP, Dion Miller says planning is underway for an upcoming Junkanoo event following a successful test drive that was the Bay Street Cultural Showcase put on last week for the royal visit by the Duke and Duchess of Cambridge.
I spoke to the chairman of the JDA, Mr. Less, and he and his organization is in the final preparations of planning on what exactly an independence celebration would be. I know the groups were excited. I got numerous calls yesterday. Everybody is ready to get back to doing what we love to do. Keeping in mind that we know we're still in a COVID environment, and so there will be COVID protocols in place, but we're just excited to do what we love to do, and that is celebrating our culture, that is Junkanoo.
Miller said plans for the next rush out should be finalized in the next 30 to 45 days, and once completed, will be announced to the public. As Junkanoo groups emerge from a two-year hiatus, the JCNP chairman also said more Junkanooers are coming to the realization that it's time to move away from the fierce rivalry, which at times overshadows the camaraderie of the country's premier cultural expression.
We want to get away from where there's arguments over the results. We want to get away from those delays. We want to have a better experience for persons who pay their money to come and view those parades. We want to include more Bahamian entertainers. So many different things we can do. But there will always be that competitive side of Junkanoo. We just don't want that to be our whole holistic focus for those parades.
Miller admits competition is healthy, but he said there's a need to provide a better product for fans.
We were so dominated by competition and that it blinded us from expanding and from evolving with our experiences because we only focused so much on the competitive aspect of it. COVID allowed us to not compete, not do Junkanoo, so we had an opportunity to look at it holistically, put all that competition aside, which is kind of the positive and the negative aspect of the parade, and gave us a fresh eyes as a unit, united, to see what we need to do to fix this parade, for not only for ourselves, but for the generations that are coming on after us.
Okay, our Tashin Robinson with that report there. Let's get your reaction to that. I think some very interesting comments from Dion Miller there. I agree with him. The delays, we got to deal with that. Absolutely. The arguments after the results and the lawsuit threats and all the stuff that happens. Yes, certainly. Competitiveness, toning it down a bit. I think that's what he's suggesting. What do you make of that, folks? Isn't that what kind of makes it really special? It is like a sport here. It is like the Super Bowl here. And you get into your camps and you root for people. And some people don't even know why they're rooting for certain Junkanoo groups. Just, you know, that's what daddy pulled for. And so I'm a valley boy too. Let's talk about it. Is that what the issue is? Or is it something else? Let's get your reaction. 323-6232. 325-4316. 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. What do you make of that, Chester? Did we lose him? Chester Robards? Oh, there we go. Yeah, the competitiveness. That's what kind of makes it a little special, though. Or is it too much? Too much. Does it really blind people from the potential that Junkanoo has as an industry, as a business, and as a work of art, as a thing of beauty? Is that causing problems? And that when we don't have something to compete for, that people don't take it seriously and don't want to come out and participate because what's in it for me? Has that hurt Junkanoo?
Why can't we have both?
Why can't we have both? That's a good question.
Why can't we have? I mean, it's only the attitudes of the people involved that's causing the problem. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
That can be changed somehow if they want to.
Hey, love to hear from Junkanoo. Tell us what you think about that. 323-6232, 325-4316. 325-4259. Tweet us, Facebook us, text us, 422-4796. Here's a text about the building. Someone says, use eminent domain, knock down those buildings. Yeah, well, possibly here, right? But as we heard in the story from Grand Bahamas, a little bit different there. Only if it's a health or structural hazard, not if it's just been abandoned for 20-something years. Just can't use that as an excuse, apparently. Well, any idea? You attended that meeting last week with the owners downtown. Any idea why the government has been reluctant to do that, to use that, to go and knock down those buildings? Waiting all these years?
No, I'm actually not sure. I mean, we heard the Attorney General say that governments only need fortitude to do it.
Yeah.
And that says a lot, doesn't it?
Yep, absolutely. Let's take this call. Good morning, call. You're on the air.
Good morning, Dwight.
Hi.
And to everybody. You know, it's really sad. You can't just knock down someone's building, like you said. You can do land acquisition, or in the States they call it eminent domain, but that takes court and time. It's really sad. We may have Junkanoo in the new port section for the tourists. I don't know if we're, when that's completed. Don't know if Bahamians will be allowed out there freely, but we'll have to see how that boils out. But the most important thing is we're going to now have junk canoe in the day, adding to the safety. And let me tell you why. Because we won't be able to afford the electricity at night. See the problem? And I can leave you with this, Dwight. I've been talking from 1995, and we could have had this Bahamas fixed with solar energy on every rooftop by now, and this would not have even been a hiccup, because we would have had electric cars that we could have charged from those solar. So we would have been riding for free, and we'd have had very little light bills. Now, a lot of politicians have spoken to this, but have actually done it. So when we're ready to fix the Bahamas, let's do a show on how quickly we could scale up and have energy security and fuel security. Good show, guys.
Thank you very much, Graham. Appreciate it. Okay. This text here, great show as usual. Cut out the competitiveness. Y'all can't be serious. That's past ridiculous. They'll kill basketball. They kill basketball. Now we're killing Junkanoo. Dwight, stop the world and let me off. I get what they're saying. There are aspects that are, that have definitely hurt Junkanoo. Aspects of this. But as they're saying, that it will always be competitive. But there are some negative aspects of this that are causing problems, and we cannot argue that that would be good if that could be reduced. It's going to be interesting. It definitely is. 323-6232. Got about 2 minutes left. 325-4316. 325-4259-622-4796. No, so that's the question, though. It's almost April, and that means we're getting close. We're getting close. It looks like it's going to be a thing in the fall and Christmas to have Junkanoo back on. Well, I don't know if it is a given that it'll be back downtown, but have it in person, not virtual, it appears. What has changed? 2 years to get it together, to stop the delays, to have the entertainment, to have it better organized, to have it better monetized. Will there be those changes there during this lull period? Did we make the adjustments that are necessary? Or will it be back to business as usual? Will we have learned anything at all? Anything at all from what we've experienced over these 2 years? And that's a question for every industry, everything at all. What did we really gain or lose or learn from all of this other than lots of time and money? And lives. Boy. Some of these messages I can't read on the air. But anyway, hey. But keep thinking about that, folks. All right, we're going to wrap things up. Chester Robarts, thank you very much. I appreciate it.
My pleasure.
Talk with you again next week, and I'll be back tomorrow morning with more Morning Blend and Morning Blend Business right here on Guardian Radio 96.9. Dwight Strachan, have a great day, everybody. Stay tuned for On the Clock with Aaron Green coming up next.
Radio 96.9 FM, Nashville.